Okay. Last week we give you a lecture given at the Pegasus La Meridian Hotel the Saturday before the Wednesday that we played it. And we told it was in two parts. Well, if you think say you hear something last week, wait till you hear this week. For those of you who wasn't listening, Bishop Spong is an Anglican bishop who was here under the auspices of the Universal Center of Truth, and he gave a lecture at the Meridian, La Meridian Hotel. And he was very, what they would call controversial, but I say, it's long time we're saying these things on this program, but true, he's Jamaican and Rasta. People feel says we make up these things. Them don't know say, after studying and looking for certain things, you must come to certain conclusion. And no matter if you go to university, up there, are you there in the ghetto down here? If you really analyze openly and open your mind, you will realize that a lot of things in the Bible that people hold fast to is illusion and fantasy and folktale. And even though we can see certain aspects of truth, when not taken literally, these people who teach you about the Bible take so much things literal in the Bible that it's so confusing. Because when a man wants to make you know that snake was talking and there is an ark, a 500-foot boat that holds a pair of every animal in the ark for 1 year with one window and one door that never opened, are you supposed to believe these things? When a man tells you a man open him hand and part the Red Sea, all of these things, when you hear these things and you start to take it literally, you start to get confused. And then you get dogmatic without even analyzing things for yourself. Well, this program is all about questioning and answering. And Bishop Spong is one of them man where, and I must say, the white man too, because Jamaican people don't love to listen to them own. They want to hear people come from foreign and talk to them. Well, Bishop Spong came and he did this lecture, so we're going to give you part two. And this is very in keeping with what is going to take place 2 weeks from now, which is the Christmas story. So he will be elaborating on the Christmas story. So well, why you put a tape on cock? Because, yes, we love here when a bishop taught these ways. We know so he's not alone in our thinking. I wonder how, I know Reverend Chisholm was there too, you know. Reverend Chisholm, I never see my brethren Ian Boyd. A long time I don't hear from him, as a matter of fact, you know. A long time I don't hear from Mr. Boyd. I met a man in the airport the other day, and he said, "Why, Muta, your name come up in a church, see him like Jesus." That's your state. Cut it edge, IRFM. As we say, put your tape on cock. You don't want to miss this part two of Jack Spong's speech that he gave at the Meridian Hotel. Before we bring him to you, we're going to bring him now. We want to show you something. I tell you something. You know, a lot of the stories in the Bible have its sister or its brother somewhere else in some other culture. The story about how creation started. If you look into the Mayan tradition, if you look into the Aboriginal tradition, the Native American tradition, this is similar stories. If you look into Greek mythology, Roman mythology, you know, if you look into the African Yoruba tradition, these are stories. And some of them is much, much older than the stories in the Bible. A lot of people want you to believe that the ways of the world and the beginning and end of the world is only found in the Bible. But we want to declare to you and make you know that the Bible, 3,000 years ago, there was no Bible. The books of the Bible was written somewhere in the like 600 BC, 500 BC. Buddha lived 500 BC. Zoroastrianism was there. You know, a lot of other cultures had developed before the Hebrew culture. The Hebrew culture is just a periphery of different cultures that sprang up in Egypt. We know that. We know that if it wasn't for Egyptian culture, Babylonian culture, and the culture of the Canaanites, you wouldn't have no Hebrew culture. And even the Bible shows you that Moses was an Egyptian, and Moses spent 40 years in Egypt. As a matter of fact, he spent 40 years not only in Egypt, but in the palace of the Pharaoh, studying, learning. At 40 years old, he taught that he was an Egyptian. So there was nothing in his mind about being an Israelite. All of his learning was gotten out of what he learned in the Pharaoh's palace. Until him kill a man and run away. And spend 40 years in the wilderness. Them say. He went amongst a Midianite and married an Ethiopian woman. And spent another 40 years studying these Midianite culture. So Moses never have no thought about any Hebrew culture, because the Hebrews never have no culture. They were supposed to be living in Israel, in Egypt. Then we come to him next 40 years of trying to get the so-called children of Israel out of Egypt. And he spent 40 years again wandering in the wilderness with these people who never have nothing. And as a big politician, he started to farm and formulate a culture and a government. And he gave them this God name, Yahweh. Now, Yahweh is one of the early gods. People don't like it when you talk this way, but it's true. Because there were many gods before Yahweh. The gods of the Canaanites, the Babylonians, the Ethiopians, and the Egyptians existed long before anybody hear nothing about Yahweh. But Yahweh and the tradition of these people, who was on the periphery of African culture, became a dominant religion and developed into what we call Judaism, out of this said tribe named Judah. Now, why are we telling you this? We are telling you that most of the stories where you find in the Bible, especially in the Jewish tradition, is found other places. And we want to play a Greek mythological story from a Greek god to show you an example of what we're talking about. This is a story of a Greek god. Why listen to this? Cutting Edge, IRFM.
Deucalion often went to the Caucasus Mountains to comfort his suffering father. He could not break the chains that bound him, but while he was there, he could keep away the eagle that tortured Prometheus. Deucalion was a good son, and his father was thankful for his help. Prometheus, who could look into the future, knew that Zeus was planning to flood the earth. He told his son to build an ark and board it with Pyrrha, his virtuous wife. Deucalion did as his father told him. He built a sturdy ark, and when Zeus let loose all the winds and opened wide the floodgates of the sky, he went aboard with Pyrrha. For 9 days and nine nights it rained, until the whole earth was flooded. Nothing but the highest mountain peaks remained above the water, and all mortals were drowned. Only Deucalion and Pyrrha were saved. They floated in their ark over the deep, dark waters. On the 10th day the rain stopped, and slowly dry land began to appear. Deucalion and Pyrrha stepped out of the ark and walked about on the desolate earth. Lonesome and forlorn, they came to a temple grown over with seaweed and entered it. The sacred fire on the altar had gone out, but they lit it again with the embers they had kept glowing aboard the ark, and lifted up their hands in prayer to the gods to thank them for saving their lives. Zeus was touched by their piety and felt sorry for them because they were so lonesome. He spoke to them and said, "Pick up the bones of your mother and throw them over your shoulders." Deucalion understood that Zeus did not mean their mortal mothers, but their mother Earth. Rocks were her bones. He told Pyrrha to pick up a handful of stones and throw them over her shoulder while he did the same. Behind Deucalion, a score of men sprang up, and there behind Pyrrha, a score of women. This new race of mortals was called Deucalion's race. The Deucalion race, made from stone, was hardier than the one made from clay. The new mortals withstood better the stings of Pandora's miseries, which of course had flown high and dry during the flood, and plague mankind to this very day. The winds had carried on as they wished when Zeus flooded the earth. They were powerful fellows, and when they stormed together, they brought confusion and destruction, whirling dust and water all the way up to Olympus. Zeus decided that they needed a dependable guardian who would keep them locked up and let out only one at a time. He chose Aeolus, a grandson of Deucalion and Pyrrha, to be the keeper of the winds, and sent him to live with them and guard them in a hollow cliff far out at sea. The winds hated to be confined. They stormed and howled around Aeolus, trying to force their way out of the cavern. But Aeolus was steady and strong and kept them in hand. When Poseidon, or one of the other gods, called for a wind, Aeolus pierced the wall of the cliff with his spear and let the wind out. Then he plugged up the hole and kept it closed until it was time for the wind's return. When Boreas, the north wind, was called for, he rushed out icy and wild, tearing up trees and piling up waves in front of him. When Notus, the south wind, was let out, he pressed himself groaning through the hole in the cliff. He was so heavy with moisture that water dripped from his tangled beard, and he spread a leaden fog over land and sea.
Yeah, we just want to play that feel. This is Greek mythology, and we want the people them to know that these stories is in many cultures. We mustn't believe that the Bible story is the oldest of these stories. And because it is not the oldest, it is not the original, most original. If we want the original story, we have to go into the deepest African, Egyptian, Nubian, Ethiopian culture to see. And we have to take the stories in context. So we want to play John Spong. We want to give you a synopsis of what happened last week when yours truly asked the Virgin a question and then say, I'm going to elaborate on it in the next talk. I'm going to give you the next talk, but we could give you what we asked him first. Here goes.
That set of rules, I recognize our first question.
Yes, you mentioned about the Adam and Eve story and how it has oppressed the concept of the feminine. Wouldn't you say that in the need to revive that feminine quality, the Christians has also made a blunder in recognizing a virgin birth? I am seeing that the virgin birth is a next aspect of the degrading of the woman and the feminine quality.
I think you're right. But I'd like not to address that question until the second session, because that's exactly what I'm going to talk about in the second session. What I'm going to do is try to take some of these principles and go through the birth stories of Jesus and show how they're in conflict with a lot of things. But yes, I'd say the virgin birth story is a sexist story. At its heart, it's a sexist story, and it's been used throughout history to denigrate women. Let me build on that just a little bit, because I won't be able to do it this afternoon. And then I'll come to the next question. This will just be brief. When the church decided that there was only one ideal woman, and she was a virgin mother, it sort of meant every other woman was reduced to being less than ideal. It's very hard to be a virgin mother. You know, most people just can't put that together. So if only one woman is ideal and she is a virgin mother, every other woman is reduced to being something insignificant or evil or deformed or not quite whole. That's the first bad lesson of that. And then the second bad lesson of that is that what the church did to the virgin over history was to say she was a virgin mother, and then we said she was a postpartum virgin, And then we said she was a perpetual virgin. And then we said she was immaculately conceived. We didn't do that until the 19th century. And then in the 20th century, we said she was bodily assumed into heaven. Only then did she become fully an object of worship. Now, let me ask you what there is about woman that is so negative in the minds of men who are building these doctrines, that before a woman can be considered a possible object of worship, she has to be de-sexed and dehumanized. Because by the time you get through with what we did to Mary, she's neither a human being nor a woman. Finally, I would say, who is making these definitions of the ideal woman? The priesthood of the church was. What was the priesthood of the church? They were celibate males. I submit to you that a permanent virgin is an ideal woman only to a celibate male.
Okay, so that was the question that yours truly asked him. And then in the second part of his speech, he elaborated on the Christmas story. So we're going to give you the Christmas story after these advertisements. Cutting Edge IRFM. We want to go into this tape and show you what this man is dealing with. What I'm saying, it's all about the Christmas story and the New Testament. Here goes. Cutting Edge IRFM.
Of the Bible. And look at it from a very different perspective. And I'd like to take the part of the Bible that I believe is the best known part of the Bible at all. I think everybody knows the Christmas story. You don't even have to go to church to know the Christmas story. You can just walk through a shopping center and they sing to you about it and you see pictures of it. And so the images of a manger and stars and wise men and shepherds and angels and Mary and Joseph are etched in our memories. Most of us have been in Christmas pageants. Most of us have played Mary or Joseph, or at least a shepherd or an angel at some point in our lives. And so we think we know these stories very, very well. But you'd be surprised at how much we do not know about these stories. Let me ask you a couple of questions just to test the level of knowledge. How did Mary and Joseph journey from Nazareth down to Bethlehem for the taxation? How did they travel? On a donkey. How did the wise men travel? On camels. On camels. Where in Bethlehem was Jesus actually born? In what sort of structure? Born in a stable. And what was in the stable? All sorts of animals. Well, that's very good, except none of that's in the Bible. Let me ask you to go home today and to read Matthew 1 and 2 and Luke 1 and 2. That's the birth story. And you'll find some interesting things. You'll find that there's nothing said about how Joseph and Mary went from Nazareth down to Bethlehem. She didn't even ride side saddle. You'll find that a camel is never mentioned in the wise man's story, that we just put them there with our imaginations. You'll find that there is no stable in Luke's gospel, and there are obviously no animals because there's no stable. That's all put into that story by our creativity over the centuries. There's one thing in Luke's story, and that's a manger, which is a feeding trough. And around that feeding trough, our imaginations created a stable and populated it with animals. So the first thing we need to recognize is that we might not know those stories as well as we think we do, because what we know is the pageants that we have acted out. So let me tell you some things about the stories. First of all, the birth stories from Matthew and Luke did not come into the Christian tradition until the 9th decade. They make their initial appearance in Matthew's gospel, and Matthew's gospel is written between 80 and 85. And they're also present in Luke's gospel, and Luke's gospel I would date between 88 and 92. So you're talking about 9th and early 10th decade when the birth stories come into the Christian tradition. Now, how do we know that? Well, we have in the Bible earlier works. Paul wrote all of his epistles sometime between 50 and 64. Paul died in 64. No gospel had been written when Paul died. Paul never read a gospel. So the Pauline writing is the earliest writing we have in the New Testament. And what does Paul say about the origins of Jesus? He says that he was born of a woman and born under the law, like every other human being. Not anything miraculous about that. He says that according to the flesh, he was descended from the house of David. Nothing miraculous about that. And Paul says that Jesus has a brother that Paul really didn't like very much. His name was James. And if you read the first chapter of Galatians, which is one of Paul's early epistles, you'll find that James, the brother of the Lord, and Paul are in radical conflict. So the Pauline corpus doesn't seem to know anything about a miraculous birth story. So that needs to be registered. Second thing that needs to be registered is when the first gospel was written, and that was Mark. It's not first in the Bible, but it's the first one to be written. And it's dated, most scholars would date it between 65 and 75. I think it's on the late side of that. I would date it between 70 and 75. But it's the first gospel, and there's no birth story in it. Indeed, Mark begins his gospel by saying, the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, and he tells you that God entered into Jesus not at his birth, but at his baptism, when the heavens opened and the Spirit descended and the voice of God declared Jesus to be God's Son. But there's no birth story there. It simply is not present. The birth story appears in Matthew. And then, about 5 to 10 years later, a second version of the birth story appears in Luke. Then when John writes the last gospel, the birth story disappears. John has no story of the birth of Jesus. John says that Jesus was the enfleshment of the divine word of God that spoke in creation. The Logos that said, let there be light, was simply enfleshed in Jesus. But there's no story of a virgin birth, no story of a miraculous birth, except that John wants people to know that what Jesus was the eternal Word of God manifested in a human life. So that in the five major writings of the Bible, only two of them give us the birth narratives, and the other three either seem to know nothing about the birth story, or in John's case, he could not help but have heard about that story since it was the last gospel, and he chooses to omit it from his records. So that's the first thing we need to embrace. The third thing we need to embrace is that in the stories between Matthew and Luke, there are a lot of incompatible details. Now that comes as a surprise mostly, because the primary way we have experienced the birth stories of Jesus is through Christmas pageants. And in our Christmas pageants, what we normally do is that we follow Luke's storyline until the shepherds visit, and then we add Matthew's wise men as the final scene to the story. But that's to be biblically illiterate. But that doesn't stop us from doing these pageants this way every year. Matthew's story of Jesus' birth and Luke's story of Jesus' birth have a lot of interesting things that separate them. Let me articulate them. In Matthew's story, Mary and Joseph live in a house in Bethlehem, over which a star can shine, into which wise men can come. Matthew then has a problem because everybody knows Jesus was called the Nazarene or the Galilean. So Matthew has got to have a tradition that says at some point he moved away from Bethlehem, his home, and went back to Nazareth and to Galilee. And so we have the story of Herod's brother comes to the throne and Joseph is warned to take Jesus up into Galilee. Luke believes that the Holy Family lives in Nazareth, already in Galilee, but Luke knows that the tradition is that Jesus is going to be the Messiah, the son of David, and the proper birthplace for the Messiah is down in Bethlehem. So Luke has to develop a story that gets Jesus out of Nazareth and down to Bethlehem, so that the Christ can be born in the proper place. So that you've got this interesting story where Matthew thinks they live in Bethlehem and has to have a story to get them back to Nazareth, and Luke believes they live in Nazareth and so has to develop a story that gets them down to Bethlehem. That's not the only problem. Both Matthew and Luke say that Jesus was born when Herod was the king. We know from secular records that Herod died in 4 BC. So Jesus was born 4 years before Christ. Now that shouldn't upset anybody. That shouldn't upset anybody because they didn't divide the calendar into AD and BC until well into the Christian era. And they didn't have good records, and they came pretty close. But most scholars believe that Jesus was born somewhere between 4 and 8 BC. So Herod is the king. He died in 4 BC. But Luke says that Jesus was born when Quirinius was governor of Syria because it was Quirinius that ordered this special taxation. We know from secular records that Quirinius didn't become the governor of Syria until the year 6 to 7 AD. Jesus would have been 10 years old by that time. So you put the dating together and they clearly don't have it straight. Something's wrong. There's some other problems. There is no record in any historic source of a government that ever required people to go back to the place of their origin to be enrolled in a taxation. And yet that's the basis upon which Luke tells his story. There's also no evidence anywhere that a woman ever had to go do that because women didn't pay taxes. Women were property upon which tax was paid. So the idea that Joseph would take Mary, the Bible describing her as being great with child, and that means at least 8 months pregnant, it seems to me, all the way from Nazareth down to Bethlehem is almost unthinkable when you recognize that there was 94 miles between Nazareth and Bethlehem. What man in his right mind will take an 8 to 9 months pregnant woman on a 94-mile donkey ride? You begin to raise questions about the historicity of these narratives. Now, that's not the only place where there's a problem. Matthew says that Jesus' life was threatened by King Herod, and so King Herod sent the emissaries down to Bethlehem to kill all the Jewish male babies 2 years old and under to get rid of this pretender to his throne. And Joseph is warned in a dream to take Jesus and flee down to Egypt. There's that wonderful story I remember from Sunday school where a child was drawing the Easter story and drew an airplane with Mary and Joseph in the airplane. And the teacher said, "What in the world is this?" And he said, "That's the flight into Egypt." And there was this other figure driving the airplane. The teacher said, "Who is that?" And he said, "That's Pontius the pilot." So our imaginations have roamed free. But you see, while Matthew says that Jesus is fleeing for his life into Egypt, Luke says he was circumcised on the 8th day and presented in the temple in Jerusalem on the 40th day and then made his way in a very leisurely fashion back to Nazareth. So the stories have some incompatibilities. Now the next thing we need to look at the story is that there's some things in those stories that just don't happen outside of mythology. Does anybody know of a star that travels so slowly across the sky that 3 guys can follow that star until they get to their destination? The understanding behind that was a 3-tiered universe. They thought that the sky was the roof of heaven, and that God lived just above the sky, and God or one of God's angels could drag a star slowly enough across the roof so that those wise men could follow. But that's not the world that you and I live in. We know something about the distances of stars, so that becomes a problem. It also becomes a problem when we read that star, after reappearing in Jerusalem, led the wise men down a 6-mile road to Bethlehem. You need to understand that Bethlehem was a tiny little city of maybe 300 people, and that the road that connected Jerusalem to Bethlehem was not your Highway 2000. It was a dirt track. So that story says this star led these 3 guys down this dirt track for 6 miles. And then it shined over one particular house in Bethlehem. Now, the story says that these 3 wise men went down. It doesn't say they were riding on camels, but we always put them on camels. They went down to that home, And they went into that home and they presented gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh with the star shining on that house. And the next day, when the wise men don't go back to Herod, Herod decides he's got to go down to Bethlehem, and in order to make sure he gets rid of this Jesus, he's got to kill all the Jewish male babies 2 years old and under. Well, now, have you ever lived in a town that just had 300 people? Don't you sort of know that in a town of 300 people, everybody knows everything about everybody? Do you suppose that in a little town of 300 people, a light leading three wise men could come trumping down a six-mile-long road and shine over one particular house, and then nobody could tell Herod the next day which house that was? That just doesn't happen in the world I live in. The wise men say that what they are doing is looking for the birth of a king. But Matthew's gospel tells us that Jesus' father was a carpenter. How many people set out on camel or on donkey or on foot to follow a star to be led to the place where a king is born, only to discover that that king is the son of a carpenter? The story is beautiful and it's romantic, but it doesn't add up literally. Now, there's some other things. In Luke's version of the story, where he has Zechariah and Elizabeth, the parents of John the Baptist, who are described as very elderly. The text says, past the time of women, which is an interesting way to talk about menopause. Past the time of women. But nonetheless, Elizabeth gets pregnant with John the Baptist. And then 6 months later, says the story, Mary gets pregnant with Jesus. And Mary goes down into the hill country of Judah to visit her kinswoman. Doesn't say what the kin is. It was Wycliffe, an English scholar, that decided John the Baptist and Jesus were first cousins. But he decided that in the 14th century. Now, that idea hadn't been abroad, but that's what people say. They were cousins. The only text says that Mary and Elizabeth were kin. Now, when Mary goes down to visit Elizabeth, the story says that the baby in Elizabeth's womb leaped to salute the baby in Mary's womb. Does that sound like history to you? And then Elizabeth, recognizing that her baby has leaped to salute Mary's baby, says, why is it that my baby leaps to salute your baby? And the intimation is that your baby's going to be greater than mine. And of course, that was the relationship the church was trying to establish between John the Baptist and Jesus. He must increase, I must decrease. So these words are put into the mother of John the Baptist. Well, Elizabeth and Mary were both Jewish mothers. I've never met a Jewish mother that would say to another, your son's going to be greater than mine. So I think, again, we're dealing with something other than history. What is it? Where do these stories come from? Where does the content come from? When I wrote a book called Liberating the Gospels, Reading the Bible with Jewish Eyes, that Sheila has been using as a study book in her church, I spent a lot of time developing what I called a midrashic approach to Scripture. What in the world does midrash mean? Indeed, I wanted to call that book The Gospels as Midrash, but my publisher wouldn't let me. They said, Jack, people read that title and they'll think you're saying the Gospels have some sort of skin irritation on them, and that just won't make any sense at all. But what is Midrash? Midrash is a Jewish storytelling technique. The Jewish people thought nothing of going back into their religious heritage and lifting a story that had been told about somebody else and retelling it in the present moment. It wasn't that they were trying to say, this really happened, or this really didn't happen, but I'm going to pretend it did. What they were really saying is, the God that our ancestors met in Moses or Samuel or David, we believe we are meeting that same God in Jesus. And so it's okay to take stories from their lives and retell them about Jesus. It's God that is eternal. It's God that transcends the time. And so all of the details of the birth narratives can be located in the scriptures of the Hebrew people, not because they predicted future events, but because the people who wrote those stories wrote them in terms of the events of their own Jewish past. Now let me try to illustrate that. the story of the virgin birth. Enters the tradition in Matthew, and Matthew justifies it by quoting a text from Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. That verse is a familiar verse to most Christians. It says, "Behold, a virgin shall conceive, and shall bring forth a child, and you shall call his name Emmanuel." Isaiah 7:14. If you have a Revised Standard Version of the Bible and read Isaiah 7:14, you will discover the word virgin is not in it. The word virgin is in it only in the King James translation. Why do you suppose that is? It's because when Matthew quoted the book of Isaiah, he did not quote it in its original Hebrew. Matthew appeared not to read Hebrew. Matthew wrote his gospel in Greek. But every time he quoted the Old Testament, he quoted a Greek translation of the Old Testament. In Hebrew, Isaiah 7:14 says, "Behold, a woman shall conceive." And the Hebrew word is alma, A-L-M-A-H. That is not the Hebrew word for virgin. The Hebrew word for virgin is betula, B-E-T-H-U-L-A-H. When that verse was translated into Greek, when the Hebrew scriptures were translated into Greek, they translated the Hebrew word alma, which means a woman, with the Greek word parthenos, which does have within it the connotation of a virgin. And when Matthew was quoting that Greek text, it was brought into Matthew's gospel in ancient traditions as the word virgin. But it was taken out of all the modern scholarly editions because they recognized the error. Actually, Jewish scholars recognized the error very early in Christian history and kept saying to the Christians, that's not what Matthew was, not what Isaiah was talking about. But the Christians were drunk with power and they didn't bother to listen. Now, if you read the rest of that story in Isaiah 7, you will discover that what is really happening is that the city of Jerusalem is under siege by the kings of Syria and the northern kingdom. And the king is out looking at his battlements. And Isaiah the prophet comes, and Isaiah says, you don't need to worry about these people down here besieging your city. They're not going to be significant. They're going to finally go away. But the king is not sure of that. And so Isaiah says to the king, well, just ask a sign of God, and God will give you a sign that these kings that are bothering you now are not going to finally destroy the city. And the king refuses to ask a sign, and Isaiah gets exasperated, and he says, you not only weary me, you're wearying God, to the king. And then he says, I'm going to give you a sign whether you like it or not. Behold, an alma will conceive, or is with child. In the Hebrew tradition, she already is pregnant. Behold, an alma, a young woman, is with child, and the child shall be called Emmanuel, which means God with us. And then it goes on to say, before this child is raised to the age of being able to decide the difference between right and wrong, these two enemies are going to be destroyed. That could hardly be referring to something that happened 800 years later. Luke seems to know that. And so Luke never uses that text when he tells the story of the virgin. So the problems begin to unfold. But let's be positive. What is the message that they're trying to achieve? Where do the wise men come from? Well, have you ever read Isaiah 60? The author of Matthew has surely read Isaiah 60 because he crafted the story of the wise men right out of Isaiah 60. Isaiah 60 says, kings shall come to the brightness of God's rising. They will come on camels. That's the only place camels come into that story. It's in Isaiah, not in Matthew. They will come from Sheba. And guess what they will bring? They will bring gold and frankincense. Now, doesn't that sound just a little bit familiar? But you all went to good Sunday school, so you say, where's the myrrh? Well, if you go back and read Isaiah, you will find that the myrrh is present if you know how to read it with Jewish eyes. Because that passage says, kings shall come to the brightness of God's rising. They will come from on camels, and they will come from Sheba. Sheba. Now the Jewish mind would say, ah, Sheba. I remember another story in our history where another royal visitor went to visit another king of the Jews. And back to the story of the Queen of Sheba visiting King Solomon, they would go in their text. And when they get back to that text, they discover that the Queen of Sheba brought Solomon truckload after truckload after truckload of spices. The only spice they knew in the Middle East was myrrh. And what was myrrh? It was Jewish deodorant. You know, they didn't take a lot of baths, and myrrh smelled good, so they'd put myrrh in their clothes so they wouldn't be offensive. And then myrrh was used to drown the smells of death. A Jewish man or woman, when he or she died, was not buried, not embalmed. That only took place in Egypt. The Jewish man or woman was simply wrapped in a cloth with lots of myrrh so that the myrrh drowned out the odor of decaying flesh. And the Jews buried their dead very quickly.
Yeah, I know a whole heap of people are listening. And I get vexed. Because of what the man I say. Because then they get vexed with me to when me say it. I mean, don't know this man. It's the first I see. But truth is truth, and examination is necessary. How people read the Bible like it don't need to be examined, like it's not man write it, because them have this notion that the Bible is written by the hands of God. I don't know where God get hand from, but them say it, and believe it, and behave like them know it, that them preach it though, and die for it. And we know, say, it's just man. It's just man. Cutting edge, IRFM, coming through.
So all of the elements of the story are in Isaiah 60, if you know how to read it. And what a perfect story it was. Because you see, the purpose of a birth story is not to tell you what happened when Jesus was born. The purpose of a birth story is to say, this greatness that we experienced in his adult life was present even at the moment of his birth. And so gold became the symbol of the fact that he was a king, the King of Kings, we called him. Frankincense was a symbol of the fact that he was perceived as divine, because frankincense is a gift offered to God. And myrrh, that was a gift that showed how his life was going to be tragic and how it was going to die. So it made a perfect sort of opening vignette. But there's a star. Now, there are a couple of places you can get the star. You can take kings coming to the brightness of God's rising and turn that into a star. But the Jews did a little more than that. The star of David rose in the east in the story of Balaam and Balak in Numbers 22 to 24 and guided other royal visitors. In the Jewish tradition, not in the scriptures, but in the tradition of the rabbis, they wrote stories about how a star was in the sky when Abraham was born, and a star was in the sky when Isaac was born, and a star was in the sky when Moses was born, because all of those were great leaders. And so they wanted to have it a heavenly star announcing the birth of someone as great as Moses. And that was simply put back into the Jesus story. And then the story of King Herod going down to Bethlehem to kill all the Jewish male babies. Where does that come from? Well, go back and read the story of Moses. When Moses was born, a wicked king named Pharaoh went down to Egypt and killed all the Jewish male babies to try to get rid of Moses, who was going to challenge him in later life. So Matthew takes that Moses story and he retells it about Jesus of Nazareth in order for his Jewish readers to know that I'm going to tell you about a person who is a new and greater Moses. That's the story that's being unfolded in this midrashic storytelling fashion. It's a very different way to read the scriptures. Now, let me move on with Matthew for just a moment, because in the chapters of Matthew, first and second, Joseph is introduced for the first time. Joseph is the earthly father of Jesus in this drama. He doesn't appear in any gospel before Matthew, which is, of course, only Mark. He just isn't there. But Joseph never appears in any gospel at all after the birth story. He disappears. People wonder, whatever happened to Joseph? He just is gone. And when I was growing up in my Sunday school, we said, well, he must have died when Jesus was just a little boy. And if you look at pictures of Joseph in Christian art, he's always a very old man. Mary's young, he's very old. That comes out of the Gospel of James, which was a third century book, which suggested that it was this old man, Joseph, who agreed to protect Mary's virginity. And so he married her and sheltered the child. That's third century Christian history. But Joseph is introduced, and it's interesting what you find out about Joseph in the first two chapters of Matthew. You find out that Joseph has a father named Jacob. You find out that Joseph is one who is constantly being identified with dreams. God never speaks to Joseph in Matthew's gospel except through a dream. It's an unnamed angel that tells Joseph that he can take Mary's wife because she is not a guilty woman. It is an angel in a dream that tells Joseph he must get up and flee down to Egypt. It's an angel in a dream that tells Joseph it's safe for him to come back. It's an angel in a dream that tells him it's now that he must go up to Nazareth. Joseph, God never communicates to Joseph except in a dream. Indeed, the text of Isaiah 7:14 is dictated by this angel in a dream to Joseph. The angel was sort of a Bible quoter trying to prove the case, I suppose. And all of that is in the story. And Joseph's primary role is to save Jesus from death. And the way Jesus is saved by Joseph is that he takes him down to Egypt. Does any of that sound familiar to any of you? Well, if you'd go back into the book of Genesis and read the story of Joseph, the coat of many colors Joseph, you would discover that Joseph has a father named Jacob, that Joseph is overwhelmingly identified with dreams. He's even called a dreamer. He interprets the dream of the Pharaoh's butler and baker. He interprets the dream of the Pharaoh. It is as an interpreter of dreams that he rises into power in Egypt. He even has dreams as a child about how his sheath of wheat will stand up in the fields, and all his brothers will come and bow down to him. It didn't exactly make him popular with his brothers, but he was called a dreamer. So this Joseph is also overwhelmingly identified with dreams. And the role of this Joseph in the history of salvation is that he's supposed to save the people of the covenant, God's chosen, from death. And how does he save them? He saves them by taking them down into Egypt to avoid death by famine. So Joseph in the Hebrew scriptures has a father named Joseph, is identified with dreams, and saves the people of the covenant by going down into Egypt. Joseph in Matthew's gospel has a father named Jacob, is overwhelmingly identified with dreams, and saves the child of the covenant from death by going down to Egypt. I just want you to be aware that you're not reading history. You're reading an interpretation of the life of Jesus written as the Jews write their sacred story, by taking stories out of the past and retelling them in the present. Let me go for just a moment to Luke. Luke has no wise men. Luke has no star. Luke changes those symbols. The star becomes a heavenly host that breaks through the darkness of night to sing to startled shepherds. Luke didn't much like magi. If you read the book of Acts, you'll find that Luke has some pretty negative things to say about someone who is called Simon Magus. That's a magi. So Luke doesn't want to deal with that. He doesn't like royal people and kings. He likes common people. And so Luke replaces the wise men with these humble shepherds. And he replaces the star with angels that break through the midnight sky to announce the birth of this Jesus. And Luke's angels give the shepherds two signs. The way you will identify this child is that he is wrapped in swaddling cloths. We always read that as clothes, but the word is cloths. He's wrapped in swaddling cloths, and he's lying in a manger. And as I suggested, it was from that manger that we created a stable around it and populated it with animals, but only the manger is in the text. So that Luke gives us those two rather interesting clues. Now, what do they mean? Well, if you look into the Hebrew scriptures at every reference to a manger or a crib, you'll find the primary one occurs in the first chapter of the book of Isaiah. And the prophet is mourning the fact that the people of Israel don't know who their God is. And he says, why, even the donkey knows whose crib he's eating from, who knows who his master is. And the idea grew that the ideal Israelite, the quintessential Jew, would be somebody who from the moment of his birth was faithful to God, who from the moment of his birth knew whose manger he was fed in. And so this story is taken by Luke and placed into the gospel narrative. And he also has David. Remember, David is the shepherd boy of Bethlehem when he was called to be the king. And so he puts the shepherds of David's childhood into his story. And then he says, the baby is wrapped with swaddling cloths. Have you ever read the book called The Wisdom of Solomon? I refer you to chapter 7. In chapter 7 of The Wisdom of Solomon, Israel's greatest, most opulent, and wealthiest king says, when I was born, I was carefully swaddled, because that's the only way a king can come to his people. Luke was going to tell the story of Jesus as the new king of the universe, rising out of the line of David to reestablish not the Jewish hegemony over the world, but God's hegemony over all creation. Luke was constantly calling, using symbols to call Jesus beyond boundaries and to call those who follow Jesus beyond boundaries into a new sense of humanity. And so he puts him in the clothing of Israel's most opulent king, because that's the only way a king can come to his people. And so the details of the story begin to flow together as the Jews try to interpret the meaning of Jesus of Nazareth. Now let me ask you to just consider one possibility. How many of you have waited outside a room where a midwife was delivering a baby, or outside a maternity ward at a hospital, because you knew that a great leader of the world was about to be born? That isn't the way it works. You know, usually the only people that are waiting anxiously are your mother and your father. And of course, they might think you're going to be the greatest baby that God has ever created. But history has a way of saying that the vast majority of us become something less than that. When you read a birth story, what you're reading is history read back into the moment of birth. When a great leader of the people of Jamaica dies, you do something to remember the great leader. And one of the things you do is to note the date of his birth. And usually around great leaders, stories develop that indicate that people recognize greatness at a very early age. You know, what we say about George Washington is that even as a boy, he never told a lie, which is probably a lie. But you develop stories where you go back to the childhood of people who have become great. And you say, we saw this greatness at the very beginning. That's what the birth narratives are. So what do the birth narratives mean? They don't tell us much about what actually happened when Jesus was born. They tell us a lot about how great people thought Jesus was. The virgin birth says that we believe we have met in this Jesus a presence of God that human life by itself could never have created. And so we tell a story about how human life did not by itself create it. We believe that we have met in this Jesus a life that was so significant that when he was born, the whole universe rejoiced. A star appeared in the sky. Angels sang. Because he's going to be everything that the human heart yearns for. That's what's important about the stories. They don't tell us much about how Jesus was born. They tell us an enormous amount of what people thought about the adult Jesus of Nazareth and how it was that they saw in this Jesus the very presence of God.
Boy, Juby, I'm so excited with my new cellular. It's my...
Let me try to pull this finally together. I cannot tell you what God is like. You cannot tell each other what God is like. The Pope cannot tell you what God is like. Billy Graham cannot tell you what God is like. Jerry Falwell cannot tell you what God is like. The Ayatollah Khomeini cannot tell you. The Buddha can't tell you what God is like. Nobody can ever tell another human being what God is like. That is beyond our capacity. All any of us can ever do is to tell another person how we believe we have experienced God. That's all we can tell. We don't possess God. We experience God. We can't take our possession and make a weapon of this God and attack other people with our God weapon. We can only say, I believe I experience God in this way. So let me tell you in conclusion, how I believe I experience God. God is infinitely real for me. I define God as the source of life. That means that every place where I see life being lived, I see the very presence of God. All life, but particularly present in human life, because human life is self-conscious, and human life has the capacity to grow beyond its boundaries. So I see God as the source of life. And if God is the source of life, then I worship God by living fully. I see God as the source of love, and I mean all of love. I mean the love that causes a mama cat to lick the fur of a baby kitten. All love, but particularly the love that is self-conscious, that binds human lives together in the bands of love and enhances our life, because love is always the creator of life. So I see God as the source of love. So everywhere I see love, I think I see the presence of God. And I worship God by loving wastefully. And I define God, or I experience God, as the ground of all being, a difficult phrase. Paul Tillich made it famous for me. He was a German Lutheran background theologian of the 40s and 50s. But the best way to translate the ground of all being for me is to say that if God is the ground of all being, then I worship God by having the courage to be everything that I am. And the more fully I can be myself, the more people will see the very presence of God within me. So I see God as the source of life, the source of love, and the ground of being. I worship by living and loving and being. And I want to be a disciple of this God. And that doesn't mean I want to make everybody an Episcopalian or an Anglican. I'm not at all interested in converting people to being Anglicans. I'm not even interested in converting Jews and Muslims to being Christians. No, I think we've got to move beyond that. But I do believe that I have a responsibility. And my responsibility as a disciple of this God is to live my life in such a way that I can build a world, or help to build a world, or encourage others to help to build a world where every other human being has a better chance to live and to love and to be. And why am I a Christian? Because when I look at the life of Jesus of Nazareth, I see a life so fully alive that I believe I see the very source of life in him. I see a love so totally and so wastefully given that I believe I see the source of love in him. And I see one who has the courage to be all that he is, so I see the very ground of being in him. So I walk with this Jesus into the life of this world, trying to bring life to people, trying to bring love to people, trying to help people become all that they are. That's the message of the Christian church. And that's the message that we see in the birth stories of Jesus, where people said, somehow, some way, in and through this life, God has entered human history. And we see the presence of this God in the life of this.
Yes, now that you have heard, time to talk. That brethren was came here through the Universal Center of Truth, which is on Seymour Park. These people brought him here, and he had a lecture at the La Meridian Pegasus Hotel. The man talking about the mythology of the Christian Bible. The man talking about the non-historicity, if there's such a word, of the Bible. What do you think? Because we say it so much time. But you know, I never hear mention that between Matthew and Luke, they have a different great-great-grandfather of Jesus. Yes. In Matthew 1, and if you read Matthew 1 and 2, it tells you that Jesus' great-great-great-grandfather was the son of David by the name of Solomon. And in Luke 3, it tells you that Jesus' great-great-great-grandfather was the son of David by the name of Nathan. So that is really a big discrepancy in the great-great-grandfathers. Now I went to this man and I say, to him. If such is the case of this mythology, and him don't really believe that there was a Joseph, because he's saying that in Matthew 1, which is not even him saying, this is the Bible said, Matthew 1 tells that Joseph's father didn't name Jacob. And as him show you that Joseph got these dreams and things, and it's the same story about Joseph, coat of many colors, him get dreams, and him father named Joseph, I mean Jacob, and all these things, and him went down into Egypt. I went to him and I said, well, give me what you know, and give me all of these things that you say. Isn't it a right conclusion to say that if all of these discrepancies is there, why should we believe that there was a real Jesus? Why is not the Jesus of the Bible also a mythology? Because we can show you through Greek and Roman mythology that Jesus is a mythology. There was no man on earth that named Jesus. Mr. Ian Boyne don't like I say that, but it's true. You know? Given all of these discrepancies, people don't want to hear that there's contradictions in the Bible, but I remember I did a program about the 101 contradictions of the Bible. A whole heap of people get vexed with me. A whole heap of people. But if it's not truth, just look and see if it is there. Because there is a contradiction in saying that Jesus' great-great-great-grandfather is Solomon, the son of David. And then the next man tells us that Jesus' great-great-great-grandfather is Nathan, the son of David. And then you have all the other discrepancies. Yeah, man, it's a serious thing. It's a serious thing when we look in the stories, when we look and realize historically, because most Christians is not interested in knowing the truth. They want to believe. They don't want to know the truth. They are comfortable with their belief. And you can't knock a man belief. But when that man using belief to decide your destiny and to decide what you going to happen to you and what how you should live, then it become a problem. Your belief is your belief. Your belief is not necessarily truth or reality. And it has to stay in a belief. You can't use your belief and say it's history and declare it as history. And when it comes up to scrutiny, you don't want it to be scrutinized because you know you add something else to it and say, you can't scrutinize the word of God. That is what they catch your people with. Because when you start to use your intelligence, you come up on this door where say, don't question the word of God. Because if you question the word of God, you're going to go to hell and burn up in fire. You think it's keep it and they talk about fire? The Christians, the first set of people I hear talk about, you're born in hell with eternal fire and brimstone. And when the fire come back upon them now, them ball out. They know why you're not going to fire now. But examine the consciousness. Examine what you believe and what you know to be true. As the man said, the man never tell you. He keep referring to three wise men. But I can show him too that there's no mention of the Bible of any number of any man or men that went to visit Jesus. The Bible never tell you of no three wise men. Never. And in this time when everybody went to live out this illusion in December, if the greatest man on earth, no one know when him born. No man know where him born. Why should I believe that this man is not a mythology of the minds of people who want to believe this story? When I look into Africa, I see many mythologies and many stories like this. Many mythologies. When you tell a man about Brother Nancy, Brother Nancy is a Santa mythology about a spider. But if you ask a normal man out of the road, what do you think about Brother Nancy? You think it's a story? You think it's a real thing? He said, no, man, that's a mythology, that man. Folktale. So why is a Nancy a folktale and a snake talking in the garden not a folktale? Why a snake can talk but a Nancy can't can you? For real. It's a serious thing. How come an African snake, African Anansi, spider, I should say, put it into perspective. Why is it that an African spider is a folk tale, but a Hebrew snake that talking is a reality? Put that into perspective for me personally. Because a Christian will lay life on the block to tell you, say, this thing is real, a snake is a talk. Let me put him life on the block. Why is the Asante stool in Ghana, the golden stool that represents the power and the might of the nation that came down out of heaven? Why is this a mythology, an African mythology? And the ark that people say is supposed to be in Ethiopia, but that evil Haile Selassie has ever seen, according to the history. Why is it that this is not a mythology? That anywhere the ark is represent the presence of God. So the Israelites walk up and down with this little box, claiming that this is representation of God. We examine all of these stories and we come to the conclusion that every one of them mythology. And a mythology sometimes is a next man religion. That's all it is. That means that your religion tells you that this is a next man mythology. In other words, if I come to tell you, say, Krishna was born of a virgin. You say, no, it's only Jesus Christ is born of a virgin. But in that tradition, Krishna was born of a virgin. And Krishna was crucified and rose from the dead in the third day. This is a different tradition from the Hebrew tradition, from the Christian tradition, that have a same identical story. But we in Jamaica, who's clouded by colonization and colonialism, we will never examine other cultures outside of the colonial master's culture. So when the colonial master talk, we accept it and we look and see that what the colonial master has taught us for 500 years, not working. It's not working for him. It's not working for us. And we are scared to go back to the root of our heritage, of our Ashanti, of our voodoo, of our Yoruba, of our Mahat, of our Hamun Ra. Metunetor. We're afraid to go back to these things because we were taught by the colonial masters that these things are devil things. Christians see with hank, them say, no, devil thing, hank, devil thing. You know, it's a weird thing. Weird thing. But more and more information is coming out. And as you gather information, your views must fit with the information, because the information is only there to present to you the reality of things that you hold fast to in faith. Because faith is the absence of truth. Faith is the absence of reality. Faith is something that you believe and hope for. Because faith, according to Paul, faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. So we hope and we have faith. But when we get the information, that is why superstition prevails all over the place amongst illiterate people. Because they hold on pan superstitious beliefs that has no semblance of truth and reality in it. I was talking to a sister today and I tell her, I say, most one who used to believe in these stories, if them sit down in the mouse late one night and hear something on the mouse stop, them not think say somebody depend on the mouse stop or somebody drop, them think say a ghost or a dopey. That is how them mind carry them. If them hear something outside, them not think say somebody. Them think say something. That is the craziness of what we call not examining things when information is presented to you. And it's only a foolish man, only the fool, after getting this information and seeing that this information is reality, still hold on to a faith. Faith is NRT, you know. Anyone can come. Your faith almost wrong. When I say your faith wrong, because I say that if evidence can show that your faith is not a real situation, why are you holding on that faith? Because it's enough Rasta get caught in that same Christian mindset too. Yes, enough Rasta. Because he have so much belief in Haile Selassie, some impossibilities, and then try to make Haile Selassie become like a Jesus in his sight. So him attribute so much craziness. Why does Haile Selassie just disappear and these things is illusion? It's like him a rebrainwash himself, getting out of the Christian mindset and rebrainwashing himself again in a new Christian mindset about Haile Selassie. When we know that Haile Selassie is real. The faith is important because every man must have faith. Every man must have faith. You can't live without faith because you have to work in faith. You cannot work because your faith is the hope of the thing that you're working for. You understand? But your work, that's why your faith becomes real. And you examine your faith and match it with reality. And you find, say, the reality must be more real than your faith. Because the reality is the conclusion of all faith. Your reality is the conclusion of all faith. So one great master say, follow the man who search for God, but hide from the man who say him find him. This is the Cutting Edge on RFM. Yes. Yes?
Muta.
Yes.
And I realized that the man that made the speech a while ago, him not really put it in the, we don't call it the African historic perspective.
No, he's a white man.
You understand?
He's a white man, you know.
He yeah, I realized that.
He is a Christian, you know.
Eh.
He is a bishop, Anglican bishop. He's not a man who don't believe in the Bible in that talk, you know.
Okay.
He's a bishop, he's an Anglican bishop who's speaking. But he was just trying to show you, say, if you take the Bible literal, you're going to get into confusion. You have to see it, not from a fundamentalist point of view, but from allegory, from a mythological point of view, examining the myth, examining the metaphors, and see how you can adapt it to your life. Rather than just saying, boy, right now, yes, a woman who never have sex have picked me. You know, say that don't make sense, but you still accept it because it's in a little Bible book named the Bible.
You see, if you run the other cassette now.
Which other cassette?
The one, the Black Biblical Facts, the Life and Times of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
By Barashango.
Okay.
The more in-depth.
We play that already.
Yeah, son.
We play that a minute time. We play Barashango a minute
time. I don't think you can play that too many times, because we level of brainwashing that, I mean, our people have gone under. I mean, this is what a lot of people, they might not hear it the first time.
Yeah.
But that's a very powerful message,
yes.
Barashango. I think he has a, and he referred to you to books that's written by all these white people. You can't get
things of course,
like
of
the
course.
Jesus scroll and all them.
Well, the reason why I play this brother, you know, because I realize the Jamaican people have this feeling that if the thing come from foreign and it white, it is more valid. That is why, that is the only reason why I play it.
Because we may believe that when I analyze the whole thing, I recognize that the whole Christianity thing is an opium that make you feel good, you know, produce anything.
It's a feel-good thing, of course.
Yes, this Thursday, the 13th, that so-called December 2001. Yeah, man, from first week, listening to the hype and showing this thing, because so many of our people, because for years, the eye Muta, Dr. Yosef Ben-Yoshanan, I, Tony Martin, many conscious Africans have been talking about these things, not for months, for many, many years. And yet, because of the whitewashing, many of our people inside and outside of Jamaica as Africans don't believe. They only believe when a white person tells them. And which is why it was so important for the unconscious ones to hear a
white man say.
Yeah, because I remember that book in the 1960s where we used to read by H. Rap Brown, Die Nigga Die. It he said, that time it was banned, you know. In it he said, the problem with Negroes, those are the unconscious Africans, is that their credibility gap. They only believe something when a white person tells them. And it is so
still,
sad.
Still no.
And you see that point that I made about faith and reality. So true, because while we must have faith, and Marcus Garvey talk about that also, and so on, faith is no substitute for the truth. And from the moment you know something is true,
The faith has become null and void.
Exactly.
Yes. But your faith is working towards reality.
Exactly.
So when you reach the reality,
hope far.
Yes.
As you say.
Yes. That's why there's a saying now, say, if you meet Buddha on the way, kill him. Meaning, say, boy, right now, you find reality. What is the purpose of believing in the thing again?
Exactly.
You know it now. Why you believe in it again?
Unless you want to delude yourself forever and ever.
Well, that is where black people are.
Exactly.
Black people in a serious delusion about religion and politics.
And you know, what is so sad, the most important thing in Marcus Garvey's whole doctrine of self-reliance is that key factor that some people wonder why Muta Baruka a lot of times on your program, you deal with the religious or the spiritual aspect and so on. But it's the core of Marcus Garvey's self-reliance philosophy that we have to see things through our own eyes and our own image.
Of course.
Because once we start trying to see through other people's, which is impossible, you will be in perpetual confusion, and from your confusion, you will always be the slave of others who see things through their own reality.
Well, I sure the question is asked, why is Muta Baruka, as you say? And I am saying to them that religion is the basis of our
of everything
impoverishedness.
Yes.
Religion is the basis of our mindset. And religion is the basis of our not wanting to come out of that impoverishedness. Because religion tells us, well, right now, it is easier for a camel to go to an eye of a needle than a rich man to go to heaven.
Exactly.
So everybody says, well, me no want rich, me just want to have enough. And black people never have enough because the whole world is mine.
Exactly.
You know?
So we lynch into that. And this is why so many of our people accept and believe that the slavery that our ancestors went through and the varying degrees to which we are affected by slavery this day is unimportant, and that it was a good thing. Which is why I have been making notes, Muta, and listeners. Because I'll be writing an article about Wilmot Perkins and the slavery question. Because it's not a new thing. You remember in the 1970s, the movie named Roots, which we know there in one many other
things. Yeah.
He wrote an article in the 1970s, it was about 1977, I have them thing in my archives, attacking the movie Roots, saying, why is it that we keep talking about slavery and like it was a good thing, you know, the so-called beneficial thing we might talk about. From them time there, he been saying it. And I wrote in response, and he was even saying, oh, the Japanese don't deal with that. And I wrote a letter to the editor. In fact, I wrote it as an article, but Hector Winter put it as a letter to the editor rather than an article, saying that the Japanese did not, no other race of people went through what we went through, whose territory was conquered and the kind of Holocaust that we went through, etc., and so on. And I never hear Mutiman respond, because you know, anytime you catch him runway and thing. And the important thing is that we as conscious Africans, Muta, we cannot stop doing things like what you are doing here.
To advance and uplift the people, never.
Yes, because never. Anyhow, we as conscious Africans stop doing this. Then no give up hope,
yeah,
and condemn our people to perpetual slavery and ignorance. Because what is so sad when I listen to a lot of the radio programs in Jamaica, specifically right now, is how so many of our people is simply the brainwashing, the miseducation, why them hate themselves as African people.
Of course.
Know? Because deep down, when I examine...
I have married up on the radio and tell people, say, it is a good thing that we come here as slave.
Which is what Muta do, exactly. And believe you me.
And that him do?
Yes.
He might tell people, say, it's a good thing, why people bring us slave? As well as they are African, slim pan tree.
Yes, and hear the lies when tell to. Because this is why... As your program and other conscious Africans who do lectures and write books and so do, sure, is that people like Muta Perkins and so on do not know the truth about African history, you know.
No.
What them know about African history
is what
the white racist liars tell him, you know.
But I want to say, I never hear him quote an African writer yet.
Never! Because as far as he's concerned,
yeah,
there is no,
yeah,
civilized...
No intellectual...
No African
intellect. African intellect, yeah.
That the only thing that any African can hope to be is to be an imitation of a Caucasian.
Yeah.
Or to be an assistant white man. The only thing that he must be is to imitate white people. He has no confidence in himself as an African, and he's consumed... like many others, with self-hatred of the fact that the Creator created him, Muta, as an African.
Mm.
And I believe this is why he's an atheist. He says that all the while, you know, he's an atheist, you know.
Mm.
And he only judges things in terms of material.
Mm.
You know, progress civilization to him is strictly making machines. That is progress.
Industrialization.
Exactly.
And globalization.
And globalization, as we know, is just another word.
White
European
supremacy.
Imperialism.
White supremacy.
White racist supremacy.
Of course.
White racist supremacy. And you know the Joe Muta, as we know, him always refer to UWI Mona as the intellectual ghetto.
Mm.
But who created the intellectual ghetto but same English slave masters and colonialists? And the biggest intellectual, racist, dishonest, intellectual ghettos in the world are Oxford and Cambridge.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You will more than ever own by itself.
And
the English who create Cambridge
and
University were in view as the apex of learning.
And them create the Rhodes Scholarship.
Original.
And them create the Rhodes Scholarship. Who was Cecil Rhodes?
Yeah, exactly.
Who was Cecil Rhodes?
Yes. Because I hear him knocking Ronnie Tweet saying, oh, Ronnie Tweet's are talking about reparations. What reparations is big we want big white people?
Well, the Jews, them get reparations.
Yes. Reparations is not about begging. Reparations is about we getting justice for our things. And as the Jews say, no statute of limitation runs against genocide, which means that their descendants don't have to do our people anything personally.
Yes.
But they have to pay for what their ancestors did.
Mm-hmm.
And if it is true, and it is true for the Jews and the Japanese and others, it is true for us too.
Okay.
I'm talking about because slavery in chains happened 200-400 years ago.
It's still
no excuse for the crimes against humanity
or
enslavement.
But
time to wipe away rape. Rape is rape. Murder is murder.
Of course.
And
the destabilization and the underdevelopment of Africa can be traced to the European conquest of Africa.
But directly. But yeah. You know, check it now. Wilmot Perkins would not want us to read Walter Rodney, who wrote the truthful book.
Oh, Europe
Europe Underdeveloped Africa. You will never hear him want mention that book.
Well, maybe you don't even know who named Ivan Van Sertima.
But
maybe him don't even know who named John Henry Clark or Ben Yochanan.
But talking even before, guess who him don't even know about?
Mm.
Because him, Sir Tima and John Henry Clark gets information about them thing there.
Mm.
The African from Jamaica, J.E. Rogers, he was from Jamaica.
Of course.
J.E. Rogers.
Yeah, the man don't know about them, man.
Yeah, you don't know about them, man. Because the man who was a contemporary of Marcus.
You know why these things happen? Because we have never, even Marcus Garvey, in the 70s and the 60s, when I go to school, and we are talking about Marcus
Garvey. At Kingston Technical High School, yeah.
These guys up at the university, the communists, the man like what you are talking about, you know.
Exactly.
Never recognize Marcus Garvey as a political intellectual, you know.
No.
Since to them, Marx was a political intellectual.
Marx was a god.
Yeah, when we talk about Marcus Garvey.
With Abeng, Marx was the god.
Yeah, when
and
we talk about Marcus Garvey.
As lip service.
Yeah. When we talk about Marcus Garvey, you know, he come like say, well, that was, you know, him not have no, you know, political agenda. Political
he is not an intellectual, not intelligent.
But where is Marx's intellectual abilities now?
Nowhere.
Yes. Where is it now?
And what these communist guys in the 60s at Mona never used to tell people is that Marx was also a racist.
Of course.
German Jew.
German
he was
Jew.
Very upset when one of his daughters had a sexual relationship with an African from Cuba.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Them don't tell him that. When Paul Bogle revolted in the 1860s, 1865, if my memory serves me right, Marx was writing for the white capitalist New York something paper in the city, and he made no mention. Carlos Moore, the African from Cuba, exposes this. No mention to say that this even happened. Because to fit them view, you know, the only way that African people, whether they are capitalists, communists, or whatever, to these Europeans, the only way that African people can advance in life is through them.
Yes.
We can't think for ourselves as African people. We must have white godfather or godmother to guide us along the way. Is the Albert Schweitzer mentality where Marcus Garvey Jr. used to talk about in the 60s, technically, you know, the paternalistic attitude. We can't think for ourselves. We always need some white person to show us the way, to help us, to give us this, and to give us that, which is the very opposite of Marcus Garvey's philosophy.
That's when I come here now and I say, look here, make we re-examine the Bible doctrines, man. Make we look upon it and see if it really makes sense.
Exactly.
And say, what are you talking about? Word of God. White guy come and show them. Make we look upon it again and see if it makes sense. Man say, well, you know, is that true?
And look how long, look how many tapes, and look how many things that you and others
have been saying about tapes.
Eh? But you see, it's a self-hatred and disrespect for themselves as African people that they have, that they cannot believe when an ex-African tell them.
Because
they don't believe in themselves.
And you can't know something outside of the realms of white indoctrination.
No, from white people don't listen it.
Yes,
it's not true.
It's not valid.
It's a lie. Yes. A white person has to come and tell them, say, yes,
this is
man,
it's
good. You know, it come into every area of life, you know. Look on all the appointment of the brother, the Brown, as technical director. You know, some people are fighting against it because deep down, they're not coming to open. Them don't believe an African can be qualified to be technical director of Jamaica's football team.
It's
a self-hatred. Yeah. And we know this is a book that you have in your bookshop too, The ISIS Papers by Dr. Francis Chris Wilson.
Yes.
And there's a chapter in it on black fear. And this applies to self-hated Negroes like Wilmot Perkins and others, who are so petrified of thinking anything different from what their white masters and mistresses tell them to think.
And he said, we can't get through without the white masters and mistresses.
Exactly. And you know, one of the lies I heard, it because I tape and listen to him, you know, one of the lies he said why slavery was beneficial, he said that African sisters who underwent female circumcision were speared that it was better for them to slavery here because they were speared certain so-called West African tribes, not nations, you know, female tribes. They were speared the ordeal of female circumcision. Eh? Can you imagine that? Not only is it that is only some some African nations that do for female circumcision, but the vast majority, not that I agree with female circumcision, that's up to an individual, the vast majority of African people did not die because of female circumcision. There have been many practices in European history that are still European people. But you don't use that to say it is right for we as African people to enslave Europeans.
Mm.
Eh? Europeans have been practicing the ritual sacrifice, human sacrifice of people. The Druids, them original Gaelic priests and thing, and Romans and thing, used sacrifice people to this day.
Yeah.
And all kind of depravities and so that Europeans practice. But we as Africans don't say that because them do them kind of wicked and negative things. We must enslave them and justify it.
And civilize them.
And civilize them.
Mm.
Eh? You see the dishonesty of people like him.
More advertisement.
Yes.
More advertisement. Yes, patronage.
Muta B, give thanks and praise, one now. Empower the eye and express goodness to the family.
Mm-hmm.
The year approaches, and there's no second program like this, Bridget. Why?
No, who that?
And me.
Mandingo gone. Hold on there. Mandingo. Yes. Yes.
Yeah, man, it soon come forward.
Yeah, where's it now?
Yeah, why is there not another second program like the cousinage bingy?
I don't know. I do have a radio station and I should have many more like it.
Yeah, I want to reply to what I have heard. One is I want to ask, the brethren is Christian, but did he express anything about any other traditions, anything of the Gita or so forth?
No, when he mentioned, in the talk about the Shaykhan thing, when he says really, him don't agree with Shaykhan, because I'm saying that the East, people, when them greet one another, them class, them man.
Right.
Like a prayer symbol in reverence and bow.
Right.
So he mentioned, you know, Indian tradition.
Mm.
But he is a Christian.
All right. Mm. My reply to it is that it is imperative for us to empower our thoughts in regard to our belief and doctrine.
Mm-hmm.
And as a religion, as we know it, is a means by which the greater order of the day, from even Roman time, has implemented to deal with a level of control of people.
Mm-hmm.
I mentioned something of Anansi, and that whole viability is that we need to look into our own traditions.
Of course.
You know, what we see is that allegory here becomes reality. So people can get a message to me, and what the tangibility is, they empower us and still at the same time control us. Religion is supposed to free us and give us spiritual liberation, but at the same time, when we came from Africa with our traditional belief, it was taken from us because that is where our strength lies, and gave us what I call paleality or Christianity. But in regard to Krishna, which I hello, I get a feedback. But in regard to Krishna, you mentioned a little bit on Krishna, and I just want to give forth a few things that I have researched over the years. Krishna in the Gita means Christ, right? Krishna died at 33, so did Christ. Christ had a mother named Mary. Krishna had one called Mathura, which means Mary. Angels at birth, wise men, a star in the east, 18 years missing, all of these are par and the same.
Mm-hmm.
Yet the Gita predates the Bible.
Yes.
Do we not see that the Bible took it from the Gita and other legends? So creating the myth of the immaculateness or the immaculate conception goes through Gautama Buddha, Mitra, Krishna, and other...
All saviors of all nations.
Exactly. Yes, sir, and several geomantic cultures all over the creation.
Yes.
So I am asking this individual, this person, Christianity in regards to all of this is really a copycat. Is it not true?
Definitely.
All right. So my input of the evening, I'll just leave that and just make a statement. We need to get to gain true change. We have to approach hand in hand with internal harmony. The elementary canal of the body is something that we see as our internal body. We need to feed it spiritually first, but we also need to deal with our foods and the element of our foods. So I am asking my family to really deal with the natural elemental foods like piaba, watercress, English plantain, bamboo to clean the joints, watercress for lymphatics, gully bean for building blood, and clean spring water, and so forth, and bath fountain mineral spring, which is free. The element here is that we have to keep educating our people internally and externally.
Mm-hmm.
And as I always put forth, Ili Garima, they tell me one time, say, 17 years ago, what the eye is a raw foodist.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I would like for that to be empowered by LATAM and other people who you can bring on continually. Because if we don't really generate that element of healing on the inside from all of the misconceptions of mother's chicken and the rest of it,
mm-hmm.
then Bingy, we're not going to get nowhere by feeding people mm-hmm. the information you're giving on the outside.
Yeah.
Still, at the same time, I want to say, keep empowering my brethren.
Yeah, man.
And divine love, yeah?
Give thanks.
One love, Muta.
Yes. That's a serious thing. When we see something in front of you. And I really want to talk to my Rasta brethren, them, you know. Because sometimes we talk on this program, and man, I say, hey, Muta come with some new Rasta doctrine. But watch a man. It's evolution, you know. It's evolution, it's information. It's clarity within information. So we need to go beyond where we believe. Because what I hear what some man say, boy, I may not believe nothing, I mean no. And it's what I know is the same thing where the Christian believe. It's a thing. And though I believe same belief too, you know. Cutting edge.
Yeah, Muta.
How is it?
Greetings, man.
Highly.
What I'm going to tell you is that man there really has something. You see?
Mm-hmm.
Because we still have to keep on referring to what you have said. The same thing you that talk about all along, Ivan Center, all of them that talk about the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
And as we know that Jamaica people, you know, always pay audience to white people
mm-hmm.
argument and black people argument.
Mm-hmm.
Well, dealing with the Jesus thing now, why my own proof of saying why me firebound the Jesus. Because remember, the Jesus is coming at the Hebrew system, right?
Well, Jesus really coming at the Greek system, you know, because it's going at the Hebrew system.
Yes, no. But what I'm really saying now, we know that the Jesus is a Greek, but the Bible really show it and all them believe it, they must say a Hebrew. But what I'm saying now, within that time that this man Jesus was walking upon the earth, right, out of the Hebrew tradition, now the church goes, they must say Jesus is a Hebrew.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah, them say that, yeah.
Yes. So what I'm saying now, within the alphabetical order at that time of the Hebrew, there was no J.
Mm-hmm.
So if there was no J in the alphabetical order.
That was his name before.
In the Hebrew. How come we have the name Jesus?
The J does come in the J.
It's just 500 years the J come in.
The J is the last letter to be placed in the alphabet.
Yeah.
Now, a whole heap of people who go to school don't know that.
True.
The J, a whole heap of teachers don't know that.
Yeah.
That the J is the last letter to be placed in the alphabet, which have 26 letters.
Yeah.
So, if there was a man 500 years before the J,
yeah,
go in the alphabet, and if you spell his name J-E-S-U-S, what was his name
before
that J was there?
Yeah,
because we know the origin of the word Jesus coming from Greek mythology.
Yeah,
you know, see, so You have to examine these things.
Yeah,
but people don't want to examine it because they're scared.
Yeah, it's true, yeah.
Them scared say it about interrupt and intercept them whole life belief.
Yes.
Yeah, see, them don't want to rock no boat.
Yeah, because even Sunday, the other woman and the one in Africa, you know, with Andrea, was dealing with the African philosophy and thing there, you know. Mm-hmm. So me asked about some Christians, so I said, the only way Muta can we really go into our African tradition and root ourselves, we have to come out of this Jesus mentality, this Greek-Roman system. Because once we remain into this Greek-Roman system, we will never be able to have ourselves open and free to accept our African teaching.
Yes,
because whatever you are saying, and all the other brethren and sisters are saying about Africa, it will never take root.
Mm-mm.
Because the man in the church, the church leaders, the pastor, them, who's getting $36,000 a month to tell you all of these lies, and hypocrisy, they keep on doing this thing, and another thing again, what are them having the people? You see this kid business, I talk about children, kid.
The what?
I call you goat.
The kid?
Yeah, I call children kid.
Mm, okay.
I don't go to know have kid.
Mm.
Because I remember as a boy, them used to call human foul, you know, because you used to make a chick.
Chick.
Yeah, my girl used to make a chick down the road, you know.
Mm.
So, did them
kids? Nobody them to beef.
And little beef, yeah.
Yeah, but I never beef down the road, you know.
Yeah.
Your meat business and the man thing, you know.
So, you see, what I'm really saying now, you see, we have to get our mind, you know, on a level vibes.
Yeah.
Where we can, where we can really begin to really teach our children the truth. Because within this Christianity, this system, we'll never hear what you are doing and many are doing. It will just look like it's just all in vain. So the first thing we have to say that, even as Rastaman, it's in Jamaica and around the world, what I think we should do, those who are getting money, you see, they should start to set up a thing, you know, where we can teach, you know, the true teaching of the African thing.
Yeah.
Like the Muslims set up in
thing. But I will leave a Rastafari African thing too, you know.
Eh?
I will leave a rest afraid to talk about African thing. You know?
It's true, yeah.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
I know rest I get hooked in at the Judeo Christian thinking that you can start telling about Yoruba and Voodoo and
yeah, that you Yoruba,
Akan
yeah.
and
yeah.
you know, Dogon yeah. and him say, oh, no, something of them things.
Yeah.
I'm afraid.
Yeah, it's
like
true, it's true, Rasta. I'm afraid. So I said, no, Rasta, see, I'm called the Muslims set up them thing, and the Jews set up them thing, and the Indian and all those people set up them thing. And this is why I said the Indian can't have such a strong talk, you know.
Mm.
And then Chinese and the Muslims, because what? Them come together and them set up them school, them set up them factory, them set up the local store where we eat our own thing.
Mm.
But as we Africans, we don't really take up that principle. We not going to tell Muta.
Yeah, we want Tommy Hilfiger and McDonald's.
Yeah?
We want Tommy Hilfiger and McDonald's.
Oh, yeah, them things there, you know?
See.
I have to go back to naturalism, you know?
Yeah, all right, Bridget.
Yeah, so guide and Muta and take care.
Yes. Yes, that's serious thing. How scared we are in just understanding reality. And then tell us the reality, you shun it. We want to tell the people them that Latam, Harris, Sun Food Man, is having a winter salt test December the 20th to the 22nd. If you want more information about it, 944-8209. For those of you still with us, this hours. Yes, cutting it.
Yeah, greetings, Honorable King.
Isaac.
Blessed out of love, you know. You know, Rastafari, I keep your tentacle, you know.
True.
Yeah, man. And I said, give thanks to the sun where you're black at this hour, you know.
Yes.
Yeah, what you don't know, say, Jesus had a new world order, I still have to say so. You see, because Babylon done set up an ecosystem to control the people already. You see, repatriation to Africa is the black people only help. You know, see, Allah and Jesus are fighting, you know. Allah will get subdued. Because Allah now have the economical infrastructure like Jesus. You see?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and George Bush has spearheaded the Jesus regime.
Bruce, yes.
Yeah, for the Pope. Mm-hmm. You know, see, because, and done, she said, you know, Jesus in Allah country and Allah get vexed and lock up Jesus and Jesus say, a war.
Mm-hmm.
You see? So right now the whole world of us subjugated Jesus and Allah because Marcus Garvey tell the people in a long time, So if you have an ecosystem for yourself, and you're born under the white supremacy ecosystem, all the time you want to believe you still have to go about to see regime. You know?
Of course.
Because I'm a feeder.
Yes.
And when you lack of food, you know you're hungry because you have something for your ecosystem upliftment. You know what I mean? So a man go depending upon Tamil figure and Nike here and you know business, but for your own development. You know, my fat and next man development.
Because I can't get it easy.
That's
why I'm calling it fast.
Really,
you know? That's why I'm calling it fast. You can't
yes,
get it
fast. Everything fast.
Fast, so. Yes. Fast yes. Thing, yes.
It's a quick business capable and even ahead of time right now.
Yeah, so you don't have no need to do nothing for yourself again. They must do it for you.
Is it?
Mm.
So you become now dependent upon them for everything.
Puppet on a string.
Is it?
Mm.
So when Marcus have to tell them to self-reliance, you know, they never know, so they might get hooked upon a system, you know, upon a like a handout system, because black people love handout, you know, free issue.
Yeah.
And like a freeness are going to them bungle up today, you know,
there.
Yeah. You know, work on set a standard for themselves.
Mm.
You know, see, because see, they know, the system build up, they know that a man, you know, I work hard over the years for all a vehicle and he just get over there. The thing so when that redemption come and off repatriation, he more left that.
Mm.
You see, that's why so much free gear you are giving out, so much laptop business and Babylon, you be a pretty person in your eyes to catch you. That you didn't remember nothing about redemption in Africa upliftment.
No,
they get hooked into the Jesus system.
Yeah, and then start to show you like say Africa one backward place and
you see it.
Disease
and the people them so love the forwardness as kind of them but them claim say it's forwardness. You see it?
Yeah.
They know I'm good at the backwardness for them students,
no,
they know.
No.
So it's an illusion then get this out, you see it?
Yeah.
And see even lesson for them own personal development because you can't do it for yourself, you know. Because you know the white man system. You know, you have to go get in knowledge, you know, to go strengthen the industry. Because you don't have no industry for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
You see, so you have to go to film school, get in knowledge, and then go work in a factory, you know, and establish film business.
Mm-hmm.
While instead of cut film big 10, you know, and say, all right, you're doing a good job, son.
Yes, yes,
you know,
yes,
when
yes,
you're done work, you know, and give him all the years of service, and say, okay, I'm tired of you, you know, I'll get a new worker,
yes.
And you get some pension, you know, give thanks to your services.
Yeah.
And that's how you get a good pension,
is it? I get a pat over the shoulder.
Do you see it?
Yeah.
So you find that the system, Virgin, is not in a pretty cause, in a time to come where you come now. And that job with regime now. Because when time blind, I go win the election, you know, get from poor people, don't you?
Mm.
Remember me tell you that because when you start
game winnings already, or you start game winnings already?
They you know, so say, you don't have no very man, because prophecy, you know, man. A prophecy, you know, man, say, the devil has got run over you, you know. I don't say NMDK Duncan can hand over as the biggest PMP member, you know.
Mm.
You see, he can declare against PMP and the media work with him. It blind and I call him a show PMP as the wickedest party of the world.
Mm.
And now you know, the JLP killed the most. You see?
Mm.
So the BBC come, you know, and can show the world, say, PMP, the Adams, the man, or suffer the people, them. And see, I got to jump on it like a crusade for himself, is it?
Back into the polls, they don't say Adams is well liked by the people.
Ah, that is true.
The majority of people, they like Adams, so all
yeah.
That work out now.
See, that's like, I want to between Adams and Blind Aga, you know?
Mm.
Yeah, because two of them get death threat and all kind of thing. My child, two of them are big friends working together. And I can't the people,
like Bush and Ben Laden.
Ah, you get the meditation. Just enough people don't know what's going on, King.
Yeah. You can just imagine.
Yeah.
If them capture Ben Laden now and them go on a court now.
Yeah.
The amount of things where Ben Laden are going to talk.
You see what I mean?
How much CIA help him do this and how much FBI
and give him power to do this.
Mm.
And give him gun ammunition to do that.
Yeah, I tell you.
Yeah, just like all the popes and Castro Cromwell have come. Contact a capitalist to divide the people and confuse their meditation because it's all about divide and rule. It's all about you can't have the set of people on one side and the government on one side. There's a rebellion.
Yeah.
It's all about split them in a two and confuse them
that
they can't rise against it. So you don't see it.
Yeah.
It's a judgment setting up on black people because they're going to take up the wrong, you know, doctrine, wrong governmental orders.
Yes.
You know, the wrong religion.
Wrong religion,
is it?
Yeah.
So you find, say, it a backfire upon the whole of them right now, because if you don't use school, they don't care, get no work, because no infrastructure not set. the white man don't see them have to suffer a certain amount of people because you know, they have to kill a certain amount if you rule the masses. Because you know, Africa man kill all people with the AIDS and all kind of things because you want to control Africa. So you see,
the politician will get you, the church man will get you.
The church man will get you. You see it. And if the politician and the church don't get you, then corruption will hold you. You see it. So either fast food or some fast sex or some, you know, see it. All kind of corruption,
AIDS,
you know.
AIDS.
AIDS, you see it?
Help you. AIDS,
you see it? See, your friend say, you know, we don't know, say, Jesus again, as I said, the new Lord and Bush, I tell about, you think, you really hear them talk about God, best America, you know. I want to know God, them talk about, you know. You see, we are just bumping people over there, so they know, and after for the masses, they're not like sanction from people there, so you see it?
God bless America, man.
You see it? So I see them matter that, you know. Come it done, sister, from the man, then go. From Allah go kidnap for 8 Jesus, you know, before the bombing go on and it rolled over there, you know. You know, see, they find that Jesus vexed.
But you know what they say, 2 months ago it was 5,000 people dead, isn't it? 2 months after 3,000.
This is it. Yeah, because, like them, I tell man.
Very important, you know, to find out what is happening. Anyway, we have more brethren.
No, give thanks to the blessings. Still, I want black people to wise up and, you know, see it rise up because Ethiopia and Africa awaits its creators, you see it?
Isis.
Yeah, man, one perfect love, you know?
Yeah.
Yes, Muta, the evil forces not try to cut the communication before we conclude. Man, bingo, man.
No, you didn't depend on the line, still, you know? Me put you and the brethren together.
Okay. But, love the point where I touch about a lot of Rasta afraid to step outside of the same
Judo-Christian thinking.
Because it is so true, because if you mention anything like about the Yoruba, as they say, they
are gone. And voodoo.
And voodoo.
Yes.
Voodoo. I mean, you even hear them and make some record about voodoo this and they don't know say voodoo is coming from the Fon language from West Africa, which are our same people. Which is a word for the creator from the Fon language, F-O-N. But our people have been so whitewashed that evil, some of them who are supposed to be conscious because of that. So nothing is... Them don't even know, say, the first man to lead the Haitian Revolution was Bookman, who was an African from Jamaica, and him was a voodoo high priest.
Yeah, that is how him win it.
And that is how him win it.
So, well, you see, you know, and that's me I say now, you see, Rasta bridging them now, them under the influence, them under the influence, you know, but there's something about reading the Bible that tell you, say, if the Bible not tell you that, you know, but there's something that when you read the Bible to know, hardcore level, it's like you don't come out tight to search nothing else. So you have some Rasta now. Him so into the Bible that if you show him a next book,
not interested.
He's not interested in it.
But let me even check the word Bible. What a lot of people don't know that the word Bible, there's a place in Lower Kemet where them no call as so called Egypt, named Byblos, the marshland where they read, because we know say our commission, our so got Egyptian ancestors and things near the first books from
papyrus.
The papyrus, you know,
papyrus,
which grew in the Delta region of Lower Egypt or Lower Kemet. That's
in
the south.
In Ethiopia,
exactly.
Near Andrea and Tony Rebel, I guess it's a fire. We're traveling a papyrus boat across Lake Tanya.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And see, and that is where the word paper come from. So when we hear some guys that are about like Muti and others that are about things, and we invent paper, the word paper comes from papyrus. As we grew it first and as we made the first paper. The word where Bible book come from is from Byblos, a place in a Lower Kemet. So book and paper is I and I, the African, who originate that.
Yeah, and the Bible is just a compilation of not many books. It's not one book, because it was written in different periods of history.
But not only that.
You know, it's not just one man sit down through the inspiration, and several men sit down.
Inspiration.
And sit down. It's politics.
Exactly. I make up different versions,
of
many
different
versions.
People's story.
And when all you read from the 101 contradictions and things, them will have to kill you.
Yeah. You see?
But you hear the joke now. Realize that in the world in which we live today, all of them guys who make up them different versions of the Bible could have and should have been sued for plagiarism because thief them thief other people's story.
Culture.
It's thief them thief other people's story.
We never copyright nothing now with that.
Yeah, exactly. So, and I pray the copyright thing, them down a prison, you know. A thief them thief people's story, you know. It's a crime.
Of course.
See, but you don't know, say, tomorrow, even right now, or tomorrow when some of them here, when no thing. Say, what a thing Muta and Manding go talk about, both say, them on the thief people story. Yeah. The unwillingness to accept the truth.
Well, look, you know, when I started the program, we were talking about Moses.
Yes.
Moses, I started into the Bible. Moses, I started into the Bible. Spent 40 years in a Pharaoh palace. That means that everything where Moses know for 40 years was taught by Pharaoh and him friend them and the universities where they're there.
In other words, we Africans teach Moses.
And then when Moses come out at the palace and go in at the wilderness, he meet the next man and married to an Ethiopian, you know.
Another African again.
And spent 40 years again. So at 80 years old, you know, he still learned from Ethiopian. And he might learn from Egyptian.
He might learn from the African race.
Yeah,
there's
nothing that Moses introduced to the Israelites that never exists in Egypt or Ethiopia. Nothing.
He's be the African teach Moses.
Even the Ten Commandments.
He teach it from 42.
Came out of Egypt. And a whole lot of people don't want to know that, you know. Because he don't want to know about Osiris. He don't want to know about Horus.
Yes.
He don't want to know about Set. You don't want to know about Mahat. You don't want to know about the Hank. You don't want to know about Amun Ra. You don't want to know about all of these things because these things is Egyptian mythology.
But you hear what to them now? The Hank, you know, is a devil symbol.
Of
but
course.
The cross, not a devil symbol.
Yeah, the cross is a symbol of suffering and shame, and I must wear it on my neck. No way. Mm-hmm. I now and really not represent the symbol of suffering and shame.
And the Hank, which is this
life.
The key of life.
Yes.
Oh,
life.
Oh, devil symbol. Don't do that. Eh?
Well, I full up it. I have one over my shop.
but me see it, and when me I say, it is a good thing that a bookshop like the I exists in Jamaica. Because forget books like the ISIS papers, the destruction of black civilization by Chancellor William, Race First by Tony Martin, the philosophy and opinion, civilization or barbarism by Cheek Antonia. We sure say the Europeans, the man civilized.
Well, you know what?
The African origin of civilization. If it was with some people like Muti and others, you know, them books they burn and do exist, you know.
Yeah, but wait, no? I am wondering, how them giving all of these things, citation and things, and never you know them mention J.A. Rogers.
Exactly.
Never hear the contribution of J.A. Rogers to black history.
Is the original.
You know, Haile Selassie did give him a medal.
He was at Selassie's coronation.
Yeah, and him referred to Haile Selassie as a perfect man, you know. Him.
Yeah.
In book. Where book them name again?
So many. You have six.
Great men of color.
Great men of color.
Volume 100.
And 100 facts.
He mentioned Haile Selassie as the perfect man. J.A. Rogers was a Jamaican who, when man never did even talk about black history writing. Him did that write, you don't have to document it.
Exactly.
So how come you never hear none of them guys?
None of them. Because this is why earlier when we mentioned on the program, when even people are talking about 30 man, others and so, Rogers is the original man. Because Joel A. Rogers from Jamaica. And not only that too, Marcus Garvey and him were contemporaries.
Yes.
And he used to lecture at Marcus Garvey's meeting to the UNIA and ACL in the States. And your boy, that jealous enemy of Marcus Garvey, wrote and said that no living man has ever unearthed so many facts about the African race than J.A. Rogers.
Yeah.
And that is your boy. And, I admit, say no other living man And how many Africans from Jamaica know that such a man African from GAA?
No, only for one don't know. Eh? Only for you don't know.
And if it was to the mind of the slaves them, were there, the slave mentality people there who think say it's just Europe count and who praise up the intellectual racist ghettos of Cambridge and Oxford, we would never know about GAA Rogers and we would not have access to the philosophy and opinions of Marcus Garvey and them thing there. Because them thing there, we're talking the truth and showing that
Africa,
yes, you know, one of the most ridiculous, it's so ridiculous, but we have to deal with it still, is to talk about that Europeans never did come Africa 400 or 500 years ago and conquer and things. We wouldn't have civilization. All over Africa, in a so-called Nigeria, we have had the Nax civilization. So many civilizations all over that were destroyed by European conquest.
The African world was more civilized before.
Exactly. European. And you know, say you have European travelers. There was, I think, a Dutch traveler who wrote and said that when he went to Benin in West Africa in about the 15th century or thereabouts, or 16th century, that he found well-developed cities, proper hygiene, roads, etc., etc., proper houses, none of huts and them things there, you know. And this is a European. But Muti and others don't want people to know that.
Bridget, you want to go to Bordeaux, man. Bordeaux is in France.
Yes.
When the French was living under what we call European ideas,
yes,
it was not very civilized, I guess it was. A set of people named the Moors.
Yes.
Bill France. Bill Spain.
But the first universities in the first university that Europe ever had was by the Moors.
Yeah. So when we go to Bordeaux, and we see the streets and the buildings in Bordeaux, and they will tell you that is Africans design these buildings. Africans build them. And it is Europe. When we go and we say that the first bath, the first street light, all of these things, is Africans carry them there.
Exactly.
You know, so when a man tell you, say, is if it was white people,
exactly,
slavery wouldn't be civilized, he must examine what is it that caused us to be uncivilized in this time. If precisely, it is not the same white supremacist, European colonialism, imperialism that still exists in the minds of the people.
Which is what books like The Destruction of Black Civilization and by Chancellor Williams and Dr. Walter Rodney's book, How Europe Underdeveloped Africa, shows precisely how this was done.
Yes.
You see? But them don't want people to read these books because, you know, the truth is an offense.
Maybe they don't even know them books.
But talking about hygiene, Queen Victoria of the British Empire boasted that she had 2 or 3 baths per year, you know.
Yeah.
And that was a big thing.
Mm.
The Europe, where them are talking about, in the 15th and 16th century, was a place where, when them lived in a London and places like that, when them performed them nightly functions, you know, urine, etc. Stuff, them used to get rid of it by chewing it from people walking in the street below.
That's why they didn't have a plague.
Have all kind of plague.
They didn't have a black plague kill 70% of European population.
Was wiped out.
Yes,
so it's people who never have no proper hygiene and bathing in Europe in the 15th, 16th century and all of them things there were rarities.
Mm.
Because in fact, they thought that if you bathe too much, it was a bad thing.
Well, really, we mentioned time and time again.
And Muta, they don't worry, me and you tell life on them, you know, because you and I can show them European books written by Europeans
who document this
nastiness.
Really?
Because we're ready for them, because we have the facts and the books.
I mentioned time and time again that when the Moors in Spain, they have a tradition of having a bath more than one time a day.
Yes, yes.
All right. When in Europe, when these Europeans see these black people bathing twice per day, you know, they were reported to the authorities.
Yes, that this was a wrong thing that
they were involved in witchcraft.
Yes, to be bearded so much
to
time.
To be bearded twice per day.
Yes.
This is not what me saying. This is history. It's history. It is written like that.
Written
that
by,
man
written
getting
by
a
European.
Problem
written
for
by
being.
European.
This is a problem for get. He getting problem for being twice per day in Europe. And it's not because they were short of water.
No.
But because there's a superstitiousness about having a bath twice per day. Because some of them have bath twice per year.
Exactly. Based on ignorance.
Yes.
And they come to about I and I, the Africans.
So the African race. Eh? When we look at what is taking place with Africa now. It is in direct relationship to colonialism. It has
exactly.
Nothing to do with our relationship with Europeans.
Exactly.
Why we're it's not advanced.
Yes.
It's a, it?
What the negativity is in Africa like that are based on European imperialism that destroyed what we had originally that
yes.
Was progressive.
Was progressing too. It was progressing.
And progressive.
Science and technology, it was progressive.
Exactly.
And then some guys come and just destroy
that deliberately.
And no, tell them so.
And then
I
come to about say we must grateful. Eh? Grateful for the rape of our ancestors. The mass murder of our ancestors. Then tell me something. You know when me have to laugh when me hear the idiot talk about the our sisters were glad to be spared from female circumcision. So why is it? Since slavery was so good and we're glad to be spared from female circumcision, why is it that African women threw themselves into the Atlantic to be devoured by the sharks rather than live in slavery? Why is it that African women in the Caribbean and in the States killed their newborn at birth rather than make them children grow up into slavery if slavery was so beneficial? And of course to Muti and others, Sam Sharp was
like,
a
like you listen to Muti Love, man.
No, you see, hey, you know why? 3 years not document people like that. Because you see, in our war, we have to study and document our enemies. So when them try to say a lie, we are tell from them. We have them documented, man.
Yeah.
Everything we say, them can't refuse to them say it, man. Because we have to expose. Because you know, when we know the right thing, if we are silent, that means that we're even worse.
Yeah.
And we have to deal with them. Case and thing. And this is the importance of your program where you're doing here. Because, and not just to the eye as the eye, you know, is to enlighten our people. Because your program is hated by those who want to keep African people in slavery, both physical and mental. Because programs like this enlighten our people and burst the mental chains
that
chain our people. And this is why we can't stop support the eye. And for no say from our
I know why you stop.
No, never man. And for no say from our school days at Kingston Technical High School and Nova Street. That from we imbibe the doctrine of Marcus Messiah Garvey.
Yeah.
We have never wavered.
Never.
Because once we know the truth,
yes.
You cannot depart from the truth. The worst thing is to know the truth and to try to depart from it.
Yeah.
Because those who know better
have to
do better. And we can't afford to deal with fear. Because if we deal with fear, that means that we will trap not only ourselves, but our future, which is our children and their children, into slavery. We can't deal with that because that's the next thing when I'm using it. Well, you know, afraid to say them things there.
Mm-hmm.
No, but that is a tactic to keep away. In perpetual servitude.
Afraid for don't say them things, eh?
Afraid for don't say them, yes.
I afraid for don't say it.
Exactly.
I'm afraid to say it. I afraid for don't say it.
See? We have to deal with things like that.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, no matter one thing we certain of, Muta, no matter how them try to hold the African race in subjection, in servitude, we will eventually triumph as a people. I have no doubt where that is concerned.
Mm-hmm.
We definitely will overcome in the Marcus Messiah Garvey way.
Mm-hmm.
Because we will never stop as African people from bursting all chains that them try to shackle us with. And one of the things that I noticed also by these, the brainwash ones in GA, the brainwash ones from our race, is that anytime we talk about having any African unity with Africans from the other islands of the Caribbean or Africa, it's a big problem.
Mm.
is a big problem. And then I notice, where some of them do, you ever notice sometime we are African or black, and the next time we make up a mixture of all kind of race, whenever it suit them. So, on one level, when I hear them say, oh, we are talking about Africa for, we are not African, we are not, you know, we're not black and them things. We make up a European, Chinese, Indian, and all kind of thing. And the very same people who say that, hypocrites who say that, you see, now the next spread, them are talking about, say, we are not that. Boy, I will tell you, you know, black people no good, you know, not no black no good, you know, you see them nigger them. It's the same people, you know.
Yeah.
So, them want to have them cake and eat it. So, how can it be that one moment, we are African, and we're black and we're not good, and the next moment, we're not African, but we make up all different races, the so-called out of many one people.
Where do them get
you
out
see the country?
Where do them get out of many one?
The people, them people from the states, man.
America,
the Latin matter, the Latin matter where the states, them talk.
America, them get it from
there. Yes, the people, them people, that.
I will if a Jamaican people don't know, say.
Them don't know that.
The out of many one is the same matter in America, you know?
Exactly. Exactly.
It's teeth, them teeth it from
it's
America.
Teeth, them teeth it.
So you don't mind sharp all the melody?
America would have sued them.
Of course.
For teeth in them matter.
Yeah, of course.
See?
You tell some teachers don't even know that.
Them don't know that.
Some teachers don't even know that.
Like Ricardo Woods, who originated Black History Month, said the miseducation of the Negro.
Yeah,
them in need of teaching themselves.
If you go to some school and say, look here, you see the matter of Jamaica out of many one, it is an American matter that was stolen by our so-called founding fathers from those people in America.
Exactly.
It has nothing to do with the Jamaican reality.
Nothing at all.
It was just taken from America and transported and transplanted in Jamaica out of many ones.
Yeah, but here the con. The reason why them keep it from America, they use it just so you know, is because the so-called people who were in charge of our so-called independence were very anti-African, and them wanted to con the majority, you know, the population of Jamaica, the majority of the population of Jamaica is African. Them wanted to take the African people's mind of Jamaica after the fact that we as a people must control our resources, etc. and so, and try to fool us with some so-called out of many one thing, you know. See? Check on my mind of Africa. No, African.
Yeah.
But that is a con. See? But there is no way that can be, because anyone who come to Jamaica from abroad, from them come Jamaica and look around for the population, you see that you are in an African country. And we say that without apology, all you have to do is look. We know if you go Ghana, Nigeria, and Jamaica, for example, if the people don't talk, you don't know where you're there, because it's just the accents different, you know.
Yeah. Well, when I don't go to Europe.
Exactly.
When we go to Europe, the only time people know so we come from Jamaica.
It's when you talk.
It's when we start to cause bad words.
You don't know so where about Trinidad.
No, sir. Yeah,
Trinidad, Nigeria thing.
No matter where you come from.
No matter where
you
come from.
Europe, you're African. Just,
you know so you're African. So this is why when some of them radio people there, I try to brainwash people at all, but we are not African. Who them a fool? And you know when would I like to be the one them who them look black, the roast bread fruit them. But I talk about say, well, we have mixtures of all kind of thing. Me personally would have delivered them free of charge to a 2 o'clock mob meeting in the States or a National Front meeting in England, and then we know say if them is mixture of what. No man, no Muta say, don't worry man, oh you're not African, you're not black. You're a mixture. You're a mixture of European Chinese and African, nothing for you, you know, you're a mixture out of many one. Okay, you can see what mixture you make out of. And me and you just left them at a Ku Klux meeting in the States. I left them at a National Front meeting. Or the front meeting in France with the boy, the Le Pen. And then we'll know what mixture of race them come from.
Let me tell you something.
Trying to fool themselves and other people. Them no African.
Them have an advertisement for the TV right now because of the World Trade Center thing. Where you hear some people come and say, I am an American. And I say, I am an American.
American was a white guy, American.
We don't say that. They might try to be patriotic, you know, by saying all these different people is American. So it's the out of many one thing them are manifest, you know. Because now them are sure say the Chinese man who is in America, they this in America. But you're the black man now in America. The black man in America call himself an African American.
Yes.
That means you know he might tell him say him is American, you know. Him say him is that him is just an African American.
Yes.
Instead of him say him is an African in America, you know.
Which is what him supposed to be.
Yeah, him say he's an African American. That means say him become less of the thing that him proposed to be, you know. Because if a man says he's an African American, you know, the most important thing in that thing is the American.
Yes, of course.
You know, see? If you say he's a Chinese American, the most important thing is that he's an American.
Exactly.
You know, see? So him become now something other than himself.
He become a hyphenated.
Yeah, he become almost like the subject rather than the object. You know,
then
like
then he's not subject, then he's not hyphenated himself. I cut himself into,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
See? You can't be an African American. You have to be an African in America.
Yeah.
Like how we are African language in funny, Jamaica.
Language funny because the man who bring up that now, you see, he might try to show you himself as being an American, you know.
Exactly.
But he wants to distinguish himself from the white man in America.
Exactly.
Hey, you see,
exactly.
Is it better if him say he was an American African?
Yeah, that's what I say. The African subject and the object. Yeah, him is an African born in America.
Yes.
But him say he's an African American now. Sure, you say the American is the most important. Yeah, it's the most important part of the change, you know.
Precisely. And Muta, as we know, we are simply Africans.
Definitely.
Because nationality have nothing to do with this. Wherever we are, no matter where we're born on the planet,
but our race can't change. What when the so-called Native American decides a film country, and
which
he want back him land.
Yeah, which is film country.
But and he want back him land. Where this African American going to do?
Yeah.
Because the buffaloes will let them side with the white man will oppress them and kill them. Kill the Native American.
Over them own land.
Yes.
Over them own land.
So how that go?
You know where that remind me of? The West India Regiment, Anya, where did go Africa? And used by the British for murder Africans in West Africa for British imperialism. The West India Regiment. Eh? Africans who go as members of the West India Regiment and fight wars in West Africa on behalf of the British races against them own people. Eh? That can't work. And the other day you play a tape there, and don't stop playing the tape there about the Illuminati. You see the boy Thomas Jefferson, man. May I tell you, again, may I mention him just for the last time. All the while, he's always been mentioned as the guy who write the American Constitution, all men are created free, equal, and thing and thing. The boy Thomas Jefferson. And as we know, he was one of the biggest slave plantation owners. A rapist. Oh, we catch the same time. A rapist. A torturer. And a member of the Illuminati, Thomas Jefferson, right? And then he's always been hailed as this champion of freedom of people by none other than Sir Monty Perkins, you know. No, you see me? Hey, Muta, between me and you. You see, till the rest. Me manding got the
gear. You love Muti. You love Muti, man. And you mentioned Muti about 50 times.
No, you want to know.
Yeah.
You see, for the rest, I will mut Muti Perkins' life as an arch enemy of the African race worldwide. For the rest of him life, I mandingo, the African, the gear will never, is my sacred duty, to expose and attack in an intelligent way all such people like Muti and people like him. If I did not do that, I would not be living to my true mission in life.
Me understand what you say, but just so much time you mention him name, you know?
But I won't mention him name again, you know, but I just want people to know for the rest of his life, Muta, and all others like him, man.
Yeah.
Any enemy of the African race is the enemy
of I, Mandingo, the job.
You have to move now.
Yeah. Aye. So keep on keeping on.
Yeah, man.
And it is good that your bookshop is there.
Yeah.
And that bookshop will make other bookshops come in all of the other parishes and so on.
Yeah.
Because the information, the important thing is that the information is there.
Yeah.
And our people who don't want to be shackled in mental slavery, them do have no excuse.
Mm.
The books are there to liberate themselves. Because them same books say, I and I read as youths in the 60s at Kingston Technical.
Yeah.
And them time they went reading and read it, them did ban. Them the government did catch me.
It was like ganja.
Would have go to prison.
It was like ganja.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Would have go to prison. So therefore, Malcolm X autobiography yesterday, them can't read it now, them not have to go prison and them thing there.
Yeah.
Them have no excuse for being free from mental slavery. And you know, so if I'm free from mental slavery, it's total freedom in every aspect.
Right,
so one God, one aim, and one destiny. I mean, I go and listen to the program, you don't know enough.
Yeah,
to
man.
The very end, and you know, so I'm full there more time. One African unity, every time, every time.
Hello, good night.
Good night.
I was just listening to the man that called in, right, who was speaking a lot about, you know, Africanness, which I really embrace totally. However, I have a concern that sometimes African is mentioned, it's as if there is total acceptability on the part of Africans. And I just wanted to comment on that. For example, in the summers in the United States, and my uncle, I believe totally in repatriation, I might add. But do you think at this point that Africa is accepting to receive those of the people of the Pan-African, the African diaspora then? And my other concern too is that there is so much cultural differences within the African continent itself, per se. For example, I must add before saying anything else that I've never been to Africa, but I plan to go there next summer, right? But there are differences. For example, I was reading Politics in Contemporary African Societies, and it was saying that Africa have over 700 languages. So there are many...
More than that.
Well, thanks. Now you're informing me of more. Well, that's good. But there are so many cultural differences in terms of religious, and in terms of religious ethnic groups, and various cleavages, language differences. And I'm afraid that a lot of times people speak of Africa as if it's one continent of much homogeneity.
53 different countries. All right, I can explain something to you, sister.
Mm-hmm.
You see, when it comes on to development in Africa, white people don't have no problem of taking themselves from France and Germany and thing and go to Africa to set up business.
To exploit it, of course.
Yeah. Well, you see, we know, we have the problem of saying what you just said. By saying, why there's so much different languages, how we're going to fit into that society.
Right.
No, you look here. You have business opportunities in Africa that we don't tap into, that we need to tap into. You know, for instance, now, Ghana.
Mm-hmm.
When you go to Ghana, well, I think a good thing about Ghana is that when you go to Ghana, you don't have to learn another language. Because the people, them is talking the same way like how the Jamaican people talk. And Ghana has a stable society right now. The more stable of the societies in Africa. There's a lot of investment opportunities there that we don't know about because we're not having any business news report about what is taking place in Ghana.
Okay.
Now, you have, for instance, now, like South Africa. And I talk about places that I have been to.
Okay.
South Africa is, from Cape Town to Johannesburg, it's 2 hours flight.
Okay.
I know, say, the flight from here to Miami, 120 minutes.
Yeah.
So you must know, say,
it's large.
It's a large place.
Yeah. Because, no. I mean, a friend of mine who's been to Africa was saying that, boy, you know, Africa, how it is shown on the globe,
yes,
is much bigger than the United States. Why
of course.
Is it that the geographic...
Yeah, but you say you have 53... All right, for instance, in the Cameroon, there's 250 different languages in the Cameroon alone, you know.
Okay.
But the thing about Cameroon is that it divided into English and French.
Mm-hmm.
Like in Yaoundé, which is the capital, it talk French. And if you go up more north, them talk English. So what we need to understand, you know, is the political, social structure of Africa before we even can say, make a move to deal with certain. We can't just go there like romanticize the thing.
Right. And because, I find that is what is happening.
Yeah, a whole lot of people, we hear that, you know, we hear that. That a whole lot of people are romanticize it. But that don't mean, say, that we here cannot find spaces in Africa that can sustain our understanding of life and also help to develop their understanding of life.
Right.
You know, see, we need to find that niche because there's so much things happening in Africa, you know. There's so much people going into Africa to set up business, development, and that is not black people.
Yeah.
We is scared, so scared that we're not going to know the language. Maybe them religion different. Maybe them food different. Of course, them food different. Of course, them language different. But more, I tell you, if you walk in the streets of Dakar in Senegal, the youngest youth where you find on the street attack three different language.
Yeah.
So when them see you, them see you as a tourist, and them say, here, you talk English. In talk English. French is the main language. And then they have a Mandingo language. Where them call Wolof. Wolof.
Okay.
All right. So in talking Wolof, which is an indigenous language, him talking French, which is the colonial language of Senegal, and him talking English, which is the tourist language of Senegal.
Yeah.
You only talk English, go there. So when you go there, you feel say you can't fit in to certain thing. But the youth on the street, I have that experience. I was surprised that most youth on the street in Senegal, a three different language might talk.
Mm-hmm.
And now you feel say, why you can't go there, go fit into it, because it's mostly French.
Yeah.
But we're wrong if you study French.
Nothing is wrong with that.
You know, see, we should have started to learn French more because most of the French-speaking countries, I mean, no, my Rasta brethren, them, were vexed with me when I said this. But you see, me personally, right now, I would prefer to learn French than Amharic. Because even though Amharic is an Ethiopian language, but it's only spoken in Ethiopia, you can't communicate with Amharic outside of Ethiopia.
Context, yeah.
So that makes sense. To me, it makes more sense for me to go learn French.
Yeah.
Because most of North Africa, and most of Central Africa, and even West Africa speak French.
Yeah.
You know, see? So I would have to suggest that, yeah, we know, we hear about these people, we know some of them culture different, but then now it's easier for we fit into
that culture
than go to Germany. Go try fit into a German culture. Is that serious thing?
Yeah. But I think, though, you know, it needs to be said more.
Yeah, I think the problem where you have is
really
the romanticizing of it.
Right. I'm really tired of it. And I mean, a lot of people talk, you know, Muta, but is there going to be a concerted effort to ensure that the development of Africa is actually done? I mean, look at the issue with the reparation of the conference the other day in South Africa.
Yeah.
What is the people of the Caribbean, what is CARICOM saying to us? I know that Hillary Beckles was there. But I mean, the feeling that I get is that in terms of reparation and paying back the black race for what they have lost, I'm not talking about monetarily only. I'm talking about setting up skill training centers and educational facilities.
Well, what I think most people...
social capital. I don't see that all regional leaders...
No, well, the regional leader is Europeanized, you know. Don't see a South-South dialogue and go on. Them say the same. That is why when things
happen... But it's like neocolonialism then, because there's no progress.
That is why when something happens in America, we feel it, so, you know. Because we keep looking to America for salvation.
Not just America, Europe in general.
Yeah, well, America now, because America is, you know, is what you call a superpower now.
Yeah.
So there was a time when we looked to England, because the banana boat didn't go to England and everything. Mm. Now, you know, Miami and, you know, New York and things. So there's a tendency not to want to go to America. We only want to go to England if we didn't have a long time parents there.
Yeah.
But now most ones that want to have an American visa than to go to Europe. You know, see?
Yeah.
But we have never read, turn our eyes to the south, which is really Africa. You see, because we get, it's either, I can tell you what the problem I have with the whole party. One, is either we see Africa so negative that we don't want to deal with it. And we romanticize Africa so much.
So much, there needs to be a balance.
That we don't want to deal with it either.
Right.
You understand? So we need to get out a little religion. Yeah. You know, drink milk only when you go to Africa. We need to get out of our mind.
Yeah, we need to get out of that and recognize that it's no accident that Haiti and Africa seem to have, have so much AIDS cases.
Yeah, the most AIDS cases in Africa,
you know,
South Africa right now, 33. It's a serious thing, you know. Millions of people are dead in Africa.
Yeah, of AIDS. And I mean, you know, the sad thing is, when you look at how the men in this country have been socialized in terms of sexual prowess that it is okay for them to go sleep with different women, sleep with that man. It's like destroying themselves. That's what they use to define them, their early manhood, is what destroys them later on, because they cannot take care of their children.
Yes.
And so their children are destroyed.
Yes, yes. I agree with you.
I really appreciate your program because, I mean, it talks about conscious things, which we really lack. But you know what, Muta, I'm really tired of being in a country where people just are drop dead like flies, so, and we just have a culture, talk, and when it comes to action, you know, nothing is done. It's just really sickening.
Well, you see, something I'm doing about it is that more people are doing it. Something really I do about it is that more people need to do the same thing to change, make the change still, you know? The same like Africa. We might feel that nobody in Africa got enough. There are enough people, enough black people that go Africa got develop certain things. But you're not hearing about it because, you know, you have to go on the internet now to get real information.
Yeah.
You can't depend upon the newspapers in your country.
Right.
You know, that is the beauty about internet.
Yeah.
That the information is so wide now that you just log on and you pick up newspaper in Africa, in Europe, in Australia, all these places, you know.
Yeah.
You are no more confined to just the dean and the observer, you know. So, leave it that. Give thanks to Carl still, you know.
Yeah, man. Take it easy.
I did.
All right.
Yeah, man. Sister is very concerned, and we love that concern. Yes, cutting edge coming through. Cutting edge.
Yes, Muta.
Yes.
Oh, thanks, man.
I'm there.
Yeah, that thing here is a really interesting fine note from that.
Did you not listen to the tape?
Well, it's not so much the tape.
No, I asked if you didn't listen to the tape.
Yes, yeah.
No, but that's an ask if you didn't hear the tape.
I take it in, you know?
Okay.
But,
long time no hear from you, though.
Well, still around.
Mm.
It's just that I forget up early in the morning, so I can't hardly, you know? You know, it is a holiday, you know,
but I know why you don't call still, you know.
Yeah?
It's
well, the last time...
You know why you don't call? It's to come out for the Jesus thinking.
Yeah.
It's a while, you don't call. It's to go back for the Jesus thinking.
Yeah,
you call.
So you kind of ring me again.
Hi, sir.
So, anyway, you know, when we really want to find out, when you have said, Haile Selassie is real, you know, exactly what you mean by
like that? You.
Eh?
Like you.
Real.
Like you. If you really like how me know say you exist now.
Yeah.
You're talking up on the phone.
Yeah.
That is real.
So, you know, could I give me a little more explanation because...
No, you don't know when somebody says something real.
Yes.
Real, it's like how you up on the phone now.
A living thing there.
Me know say you exist, you're real. You say to me, God is an experience.
Yeah.
That means that God is only real to the man who experienced God.
Uh-huh.
You can't tell me that God exists if I don't experience God.
So in what way you experience the emperor now?
No, I never tell you I experience the emperor. I experience the emperor because I know him real, like you depend on the phone and all.
Yes.
It is not a matter of I experience in Haile Selassie. I'm telling you.
Uh-huh.
You ask me about real. What I mean when I say Haile Selassie is real.
Yeah.
And I say Haile Selassie is real, just like you depend on the phone now and I know say. It's not a dopey attack to me.
But...
He's a man.
But, you know, there's a whole lot of illusion to, as far as I'm concerned, that is associated with the whole belief in...
Haile Selassie?
Yes.
You know, you made us attack them a while ago. You know, you made us attack them a while ago.
You know,
I was just tackling them a while ago.
Yeah.
You never hear me?
I hear you.
Okay.
But at the same time, I'm wanting the virgin them hear you. But you know what I'm saying?
Let me hear me, man. And if you are eating to them, you hear me and them not hear me.
It's a long time you're waiting a campaign against this whole idea of the Christian belief.
And Rasta thinking too. Don't forget.
But...
It's not only Christian belief attack also some of the beliefs of a Rasta brethren.
Say for instance, you succeed...
You have to give me that credit, man.
No, so, say for instance, you succeed in eliminating them.
Yeah?
Now, what would you replace them with?
Replace what with?
The belief in Christianity and a belief in Haile Selassie.
Replace?
No, I mean, you have to have something to believe in, you know?
Yeah, we not say no.
Yes.
But you believe in that thing until the point where you realize that belief and reality and substantiating reality is more evident than believing in something. That is what belief... belief is to the point where you don't know. So when you know, belief take a back seat.
But sometimes the information that you confirm your belief with, you know, is questionable to you.
All right. So, I know, say, there's a man named Haile Selassie.
Yes. But
I know. I know.
Yes.
Say, Haile Selassie was the emperor of Ethiopia.
Yeah.
I don't believe that. No. I believe that there was a man named Jesus.
Yes.
That is what the Christians believe.
Yeah.
No, I believe, said Jesus, born of a virgin.
And you believe that?
Yeah, wait, no. I tell you what the Christian them say.
Okay.
The Christian them believe, say, this man born of a virgin. The Christian them believe, say, him walk by water. The Christian them believe, say, feed 5,000 people tree. If them don't know that. No. When you use intelligence,
yeah,
information, and come to conclusion, you realize it is just, it must stay in a belief. You cannot impose that belief as knowledge on a set of people or a group of people. You must make that belief sustain you and yourself. Don't try to impose it on people. And anytime you start to impose belief,
yeah,
from people, then you're going to have a problem.
Then what is wrong with belief?
I never said, oh my gosh, man. I never said nothing wrong with belief.
Yeah.
Every man believe in something. You know why you were saying that? You know why you mean another virgin attack?
Yes. But, you know, sometimes, you know,
I never said something is wrong with belief.
Yeah.
Something is wrong with belief when the truth and the reality is facing you and you still hold on to a belief that does not correspond with the truth and the reality. That is what is wrong with belief.
Well, the truth is, would you say the emperor was a Christian?
Of course.
Yes. So, you know,
so what happened to that?
Well, I don't understand, you know. Yeah, you revere this emperor.
And he was a Christian.
Yes.
So what is wrong with that?
Well, what I'm saying, you know, if you really respect
Jesus Christ was not Christian.
Eh?
Jesus Christ was not Christian.
Yeah, but he never tell anybody to worship him.
No, I never said tell nobody that. I have said Jesus Christ was not Christian.
Yes. I can understand that.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. But at the same time, the whole idea of Christianity is built up around the word that was uttered from his mouth.
But you don't know that.
Eh?
That is why you believe.
But, yeah,
because you don't know that Jesus said these things were in the Bible.
Have you ever studied words?
No. Study whose work?
The word in quotations that in the Bible.
No, man. The quotations in the Bible was put there by men who believe.
Well,
there's no...
So.
There's no book.
Doesn't make a lot of sense.
No, there's no book in the Bible that Jesus wrote.
Yeah.
Every man who write about Jesus.
These words that were written
here,
down there.
None of the man them who write about Jesus did ever know him, did ever see him yet, or never did even,
you know,
come across him.
The faith is the word, you know, the word is still there, you know, because.
Brethren.
The word.
Brethren.
Live,
none of the men them who wrote about Jesus did ever see him. Didn't know him.
You know, a lot of brethren sing about Emperor Haile Selassie. I've never seen him.
But them know him exists. And you have books where him himself writes. That's where people write about him.
But.
No, listen.
Yeah.
You have books by Haile Selassie. You have tape recorder in a Haile Selassie time. You have film in a Haile Selassie time.
Yeah.
That means a man can stand up in front of Haile Selassie when he make a speech and tape him and come back complete. And you know. Say, this is Haile Selassie words. The words in the Bible that is ascribed to Jesus.
Yeah.
No one know that there was a man who named Jesus. Said
so what has Emperor Haile Selassie done to deserve this sort of reverence?
He don't have to deserve nothing.
Uh-huh.
It's I healing him up.
Oh.
You don't have to heal him, you know. It's I heal him. I have said to you that
yeah.
I know Haile Selassie. I have heard. I have seen Haile Selassie. With my own eyes.
Uh-huh.
I have heard him speak. I know that there's a man
uh-huh.
named Haile Selassie. You don't know that there was a man named Jesus. You believe that. And the words in the Bible that is ascribed to Jesus Christ.
So
you don't know.
Are you saying that Haile Selassie himself was misled into believing into these words? Because was inspired a great deal by the Bible.
But the Bible is inspiring. The Bible inspired a whole generation and generation. I don't have no problem with that.
Yes.
The Quran inspired a whole bunch of people. The bag of Vita inspired a whole lot of people.
I think your problem don't in the motor as far as Christianity is concerned.
I do have no problem. What a problem, you know what my problem is?
Yeah.
My problem is when you have a belief and a faith.
Yeah.
And you try to put it on me and say, this is how it got historically. That is my problem.
No, no, you see, the European Ethiopia was the first Christian nation, do you know?
So what that mean?
Uh-huh.
What that mean?
Ethiopia.
So what that mean?
I'm saying that if there was no value to Christianity, there was
no
spiritual value.
I never said there's no value to it.
Yeah.
There must be a value to it if 1 billion people accept it.
Yes.
I never said there's no value.
I mean, you actually find it reprehensible?
Yes! Because it's enslaving black people.
In
for
what
500
way?
Years.
In what way? Because the religion is that we have been feeding on, you know, is really our history, you know.
Which history?
Huh?
Which history?
The whole idea of this written word coming down from one generation, from one century, from one...
I don't know my history.
Oh, you mean?
No, man.
The Nile run from the highlands of Ethiopia down to the lowlands of Egypt, you know.
So what that mean?
I am saying.
So what that mean? You know why your man make movie about place, Gotham City?
Huh?
You know why your man make movie about Batman? You think Batman never in our city? You don't say them call the name of streets in New York to show you that Batman exists.
Well, America,
don't you know that Superman?
America will win mingling.
No, but the same thing with the Bible. You're calling places that exist.
Yeah.
And because people them call the place that exists, you're saying the thing must did happen. That
no,
don't
man,
make no sense.
This is real thing.
Because... Yeah, but Superman exists.
Huh?
Superman exists.
No,
you never see Superman fly over the Statue of Liberty.
Now let's not confuse what...
No, it's not. No, it's the same. It's the same thing. You think up a story and put it in a place that is real. You think up a story, you put the thing in the place that is
not
real.
The Bible of...
There's no Brother Nancy, time, you know. But Brother Nancy is a Santa spider. Huh? There's no Brother Nancy.
But no, man, get real.
Of course, I'm getting real. I am getting real. Because you people want me to believe that a Jewish snake was talking to a woman.
Uh-huh.
And you people want me to believe that a man hold up a rod.
A Jewish snake.
Then I'm not a Jewish snake. I couldn't handle that snake.
What?
Because a Jewish story.
Who is a Jew?
Who is a Jew?
Yeah.
You tell me why.
But there were a whole lot of Ethiopians who are Jew, you know.
No, them become Jew.
No.
Them become.
Yeah, people become Jew.
They don't become.
Yeah, but you make it seem like it's a racial thing.
No, I'm an Ethiopian first. I can't be an Ethiopian and not be a Jew.
And what the emperor himself was a Jew, you know.
Who said that?
No,
you ever hear the Haile Selassie mention himself as a Jew?
His emperor Haile Selassie was the conquering line of the tribe of Judah. Does it have to be a Jew?
No, sir.
Eh?
No, sir.
No?
No, go, sir.
This whole idea of giving himself this title of the conquering line
who
of
give
the
himself,
tribe of Judah.
I know how you have to give himself a title, eh?
Eh?
The title is a tradition of Ethiopia.
Eh?
It's not Haile Selassie.
But you have to be a member of the tribe of Judah to become the conquering line of the tribe of Judah.
Yeah, I am saying to you.
Uh-huh.
You say Haile Selassie give himself that title.
Yeah.
I am saying to you that Haile Selassie did not give himself that title.
But
that title is a tradition of
Ethiopia. In the book I was reading earlier with Leonard Mosley, Haile Selassie the conquering line.
Yeah, I read it though.
Huh?
I read it though.
Yes, but I'm saying that to be a member of the
emperor.
Tribe of Judah.
You have to be from that lineage.
Yes.
Yeah, so what happened?
So I'm saying that then he must have been a Jew then.
No. Who is a Jew?
Because
who is a Jew?
A Jew is really a person who believes in the whole Testament, you know, the whole laws of Moses, and build up a whole bunch of rituals and things around it. You know.
Look here.
Uh-huh.
It's like what you have, Falasha.
Yeah.
Falasha, you can't go to Ethiopia and call the people in Falasha, you know.
Uh-huh.
Falasha is like you are called a man coolie.
Yeah.
It is not accepted.
Is an Ethiopian Jew.
No, it's Beta Israelite. They call themselves Beta Israel.
Oh.
All right, so you don't say Falasha.
So, this whole idea of Judaism is a European heresy, you know, because...
Judaism.
Yeah.
I am saying to you, I is Rasta now.
Yeah.
And I tell you about Haile Selassie. I don't talk about where Haile Selassie is. I talk about where I am in relationship to Haile Selassie.
Muta.
Don't tell me about where Haile Selassie is. Tell me about my relationship with Haile Selassie.
As an individual,
yes.
What do you benefit? What are the benefits for believing, for calling yourself a Rastafarian.
What is my benefit?
What are the benefits?
You really want me to tell you that?
Yeah, man.
Why?
Because you say.
Because what difference make in your life? Wait, what difference make in your life when I tell you that?
Huh? That, suppose I see this thing as, you know, real.
You try to make me out into a crusader. You try to make me out into a crusader. I am not a crusader.
No. You have to explain the belief. You look call here. Yourself a Rastafarian.
I have to explain it. For why? You're going to put me in, you're going to behead me?
No, man.
So wait a minute, so I have to explain it. I don't have to explain nothing to you.
No, I mean, if you're going to... Use
a Christian, don't it?
Proselytize it.
Use a Christian, don't it?
Huh?
Go use a Christian?
No, I'm an Israelite, you know.
You're not a Christian.
But I have...
No, I ask you, you're a Christian?
I say I'm an Israelite.
All right, so you're not a Christian then?
Nobody's born a Christian.
Oh, gosh, man.
Nobody's born a Muslim. Nobody's
born nothing. You don't ever born Vina, heterosexual neither. So what happened?
So I'm saying that I'm an Israelite first, and if there's a religious label I have to associate myself with, I would gladly...
All right, you're an Israelite. All right, you're an Israelite.
Yes.
I am not an Israelite.
Well, you see, that's another party, not...
No, I'm trying to show you, I am not trying to convert you. I am not trying to convert you to Rasta. I am not trying to convert you to Rasta. So I don't have to explain to you why I am a Rasta, because you cannot kill me for being a Rasta.
I mean, you can't just sing a song, you know, recite a poem and think that people should, accept that.
No, I never tell you. No, wait there. None of my poems, them, is preaching nothing, you know. My poems is expressing what I feel about situations in the society. I'm not preaching to nobody and say, why you have to heal Jah, or it's lightning and thunder will kill you. I have never written a poem like that.
Yeah.
I have never written a poem saying, if a man not heal Jah, lightning will kill him. And if a man not praise Rastafari, him or dead. I have never written a poem like that.
For the whole of
all of my poems is written on the basis that this is a condition that I am seeing and it's what I'm writing about.
Yeah.
I don't write to convert people.
There must be some reasonable explanation to life, don't you think so?
What is the reasonable explanation to life?
No, if I say, explain to me, what are the benefits of being a Rasta?
Yeah, but you see, that is what only people always call me to Rasta.
No, man.
I must explain to you why the
benefit.
What is the benefit of Rasta?
What are the benefits?
What does it benefit you?
To be a Christian.
If it benefit me to be a Rasta.
Well, you see, the thing is...
I'm not trying to convert you.
No, I'm not going
to
convert
you. You think I come on the radio to convert people to Rasta? I don't come here to convert people to no Rasta.
What I'm saying, you see, if you ask me as a Christian then, what as a religious belief, not as a...
Yeah, what is the benefit of
what are the benefits?
You will say it.
Yes.
But I am saying, I am then no obligation to defend why I'm a Rasta to you.
No, it wouldn't be to me, you know, personally.
Is you are talking to? I'm not talking to. You are talking to.
You know,
is you ask me the question?
There's
I am
a
not.
A lot of people who are out there thinking that this whole idea of being a Rastafarian leave one without some kind of hope.
Yeah, just like any other Christian.
Yeah.
How will people believe say Christianity lead them without hope? How will people believe the Muslim lead them without hope?
No, a Christian could never believe that Christianity. It's a hopeless thing, even in this life or the other. But I am saying that there must be some kind of hope.
You're right, you're not a hope. You're not listening to the program, you know.
The salvation, then.
You're not listening
to
the
salvation.
You
believe that there's some form of salvation.
Salvation for what?
Huh?
Salvation for what?
Now, let's get to the human.
Salvation for what?
I am saying.
What am I being salvation about?
The fact that we are not just mere flesh, you know.
No, tell me, what are you telling me? What is the meaning of salvation?
Some kind of hope beyond this.
But I am hopeful in many things.
Uh-huh.
But what are you calling about salvation? What do you mean when you say salvation?
I am saying.
Some kind of hope beyond what? Why you keep for 1 or 2 years now you're coming to me with this thing? Why are you trying to convert me?
No, I'm not trying to convert you.
I'm not trying to convert you, you know.
You
is an Israelite? Just keep on being an Israelite. I tell you, he's a Rasta.
I am saying,
you don't have to explain to me why he's an Israelite, you know.
As an Israelite,
I never explained, I never asked you.
Yeah.
You see, from the time you are telling me, say, you're Israelite,
yeah.
I never asked you to explain what benefits it, you know. You don't have no obligation to me
uh-huh.
to explain why he's an Israelite.
But Muta, you have taken up on your head, you know.
To what?
To wage a relentless campaign.
Yeah, because I have seen what the Christian faith is doing to the minds of the people.
But
no.
What is your faith doing to your mind?
My mind?
Yeah.
You don't see? My faith is waking up to the realization that this thing is not working for black people.
I hear you condemning Christianity, but you're not putting forward reasonable explanation.
Why are you condemning it? Why are you condemning it?
Yeah.
And I'm putting up forward no explanation. So all the time you listen to me, you don't hear no explanation. You don't hear me saying that these people has perpetuated a mythology and make
who
it become a
people?
History.
Who are these people?
The people who give you the story. The story that snake attacked a woman in a garden, literally.
You know, it was only recently, you know, it was only recently the Europeans had dismissed a great deal of superstition and ignorance. And I'm going to tell you this. When Christianity was introduced into Europe, they associated with a whole lot of their pagan ways and paganism and all superstitious ways. You know, they associated in order to find Christianity acceptable. The Europeans associate their own little idiosyncrasies to Christianity.
Yeah, like a man, like a woman not having sex and having a child.
Yeah, those are myths that are associated with a particular.
Yeah,
group
well,
of people.
What you must know, you must go and tell the Christians.
Yeah.
That these things are mythology.
No. Christianity itself is not a mythology.
No, listen to
it
me.
It is based on facts.
What is the fact that a woman, that a woman is never have, what is the fact that a man born?
The man who spoke or died
really?
2,000 years ago.
He never come to sex?
It's irrelevant. It doesn't matter how it came. It doesn't matter to me.
But it does not matter to you.
I find much comfort in words.
It don't matter to you, you know.
Yeah.
But it matters to a million of people, because if them ever tell the people them say, Mary was a normal woman, I have sex.
Yeah.
The glorification of Jesus Christ would diminish. It would diminish. Because the basis of Christian belief is that this man came of a virgin, died on a cross, and raised from the dead. That is the basis of Christian belief. And if you start to tell the people them that this man did come normal and dead and never raised from the dead, then your faith
who
is in,
that and who based Christianity and that type of belief?
Every Christian
but
that
Christ
I talk
himself,
to.
Did Christ himself based
listen,
his religion is
Christ.
Yeah.
Listen to me.
Yeah.
Every Christian that I have spoken to in my life
uh-huh.
believe that Jesus Christ born from a woman who never have sex, dead upon a cross, and raised from the dead and gone to heaven. Every Christian that I talk to believe
no,
that.
You talk to church attendance.
No, I say.
No, you're talking to church.
So attendance. You don't want a Christian to believe that?
Huh?
You don't want a Christian to believe that?
I know a lot of church attendants who believe
no,
that.
No, I say.
And
you don't know no Christian. Listen to me now, man.
Me
ask you.
Religion.
You don't know no Christian who believe that.
Huh?
You don't know no Christian who believe that.
I've never known a Christian that believe.
You don't know no Christian who believe that Jesus Christ born of a virgin, dead upon the cross, and raised from the dead.
I know Pentecostals, and I know Roman Catholics and Protestants. I know a whole lot of those type of people.
And them are no Christian.
Well, you know.
You's a pious brother, you.
Eh?
You're a pious man.
No.
You're self-righteous.
In what way?
Because here's you now.
Yeah.
I am telling you that I know a whole heap of Christian.
No, you know a lot of church attendants.
So them is not Christian then?
You go on in the title, Christian.
So people who believe this is not Christian.
People who believe, who are a Christian are those that believe in Christ himself.
Yeah, I am saying.
Yeah. That is
people,
some church dogma.
You hear what I'm asking?
Yeah.
People who believe that Jesus Christ was born of a virgin, died on a cross, and raised from the dead physically. These people are not Christians.
No.
All right.
No.
All right.
Because
next subject.
I would say the emperor.
Next subject,
is a
man.
You know, say the emperor is a Christian.
Next subject. Next subject.
Well,
can you ask me, or you come double up a question where you may answer way down the line already. You asked us already about the emperor and I'm going to tell you yes.
Yeah.
So you asked me it again.
No, I'm not saying
that.
Say, the
next
type
subject.
Of Christian that I am is,
next
is
subject.
The type that the emperor was.
Next subject. Next
anyway,
subject. Because he's pious and you're self-righteous.
Why?
Because you is telling me that these people believe that it's not Christian.
But you're defending them now and earlier before.
I'm not defending them. I said that is what.
I'm telling them how.
I'm not defending them. Hey, all the man I'm going to the man now, saying so that's that. I am trying to show you what the Christians believe.
And revelation, they're still hanging on to it. You know, what I'm saying, your perception of the truth does not necessarily correspond with what is morally and spiritually truthful, you know.
But I wasn't trying to identify my moralistic ways with yours, either bad people one.
Well, you know.
I know you cook food, I'm not trying to impose it on you.
Well, you know, I mean, regardless.
I don't have on shoes, I'm not trying to tell you must wear shoes.
But, you know, I mean, every man have a right to live his own life.
Yeah, but not that, may I try to show you, brethren?
But
so why you try to impose Jesus from me far?
Muta,
why you try to impose Jesus from me far?
Subject of Christianity, and whenever you start waging a war against it,
you didn't hear Mr. Spong. You didn't hear Spong. You didn't hear that the Bishop Spong.
That man himself is a European. I'm talking about.
Yeah, Jews, I know that you asked if you didn't hear him.
As if the Jews is a race unto itself,
come on.
Unto themselves.
You come like an artist, don't ask you.
Yeah, I heard him.
You heard him.
That doesn't mean anything.
You don't call him. He means not a Christian to you.
Yeah?
He means not a Christian.
In his own way, I suppose, he have, what is there like a,
Time don't believe there was a virgin birth.
Mingling Christianity with errors and falsehood.
Mm.
Doesn't necessarily make it right, you know.
Why come, why not? You have a church?
Huh?
You have a church?
My church, you see, is the word of Christ.
Yes.
At that him build him church, and you know.
Mm-hmm. Who build him church, buddy?
Christ himself, and that little rock, that little word.
Yeah.
You know, the Messiah.
You own anything? You own anything? You own anything?
Huh?
You own anything?
Like what?
House, car, telephone, radio. You own anything?
There are certain little things that you could associate personal belonging.
Okay.
But I'm saying that.
Them said Jesus Christ never won nothing. As a matter of fact, him say you mustn't even take certain things from people when you go preach the gospel. So
it's because you don't understand.
You don't understand it.
The idea of him coming 2,000 years ago.
Your interpretation.
The whole idea was not to own anything.
You mean I don't understand your interpretation?
No, listen, go back into his word and read it before you condemn
him. Oof a word.
Yeah?
Oof a word.
The word, the Bible.
The word ascribed to
him. Man with good understanding.
Mm.
If the emperor.
Which part of the man work? Which part of your work?
Wisdom. Eh?
Where you work?
I don't really work in them.
You don't work?
No.
Hey. So you worship?
You know, you have to worship.
Worship, work is worship to me.
No, I don't worship in that
you
sense.
Don't, work is worship.
As a man.
So you don't earn money a week time, month time, yearly?
Of course, I have to find somewhere.
So where you do? So you don't work, so where you get money? You tease people, you rob people then?
No, I wouldn't go to that extreme.
So you don't work, and you have money. So where you get money from? You have a big rich family where they don't have money for you.
I tell you, that blessing come in many ways.
Oh, it dropped from the sky like manna.
I'm telling you, it's almost like that. But yes, I've been provided for. And I try not to
get real,
have
man.
Problem to anybody.
Get real, man.
No, I've been provided for.
Get real.
Eh?
You have children?
10.
You have 10 children? How much woman?
Well, it was a result of two. But,
two women?
But as a result of trying to keep the peace.
So how much one have for you? How much the other one have for you?
Six and four.
And all of them alive?
Yeah, all of them.
So is them old enough that you do have to work for them?
About all of them in school.
All of them in school? 10 of them? So you have enough school for your January to come?
I'm telling you.
So you're well rich. You're a rich man.
Rich in spirit.
No, I'm not talking about school fee, rich.
Wisdom.
No, wisdom can't pay a school fee.
I tell you that I'd use my wisdom.
To pay the school fee. To pay the school fee.
To get what is necessary.
No, that means that it's money to pay a school fee.
Yes, yes.
So how you get that money? Through your wisdom, tell me.
Well, it's a long story.
No, well, tell me short version. Tell me the edited version.
20 odd years ago, I said that if I am to serve God, in the way that a man is supposed to serve. You can't serve him on money.
Yeah, but I not serve money.
I said,
you have 10 picnic.
Yes.
And the 10 of them go to school.
Yes.
So I know, say, January come, it's not free business that go on at school now.
Yes.
You have to find book.
It's really a big business.
Yeah, so what may I say now? As a father of 10 children,
yes.
How do you acquire money to send your children to school? That simple question, don't make it intellectual, Rasta.
Uh-huh.
It's a simple, ratted question, may I ask you?
Well,
how do you acquire money to send your 10 children to school?
Well, I can build a house, you know.
You build a house?
Mm-hmm.
So you're an architect?
Not necessarily. I just have a piece of land and I put up a few rooms and rent them.
So you get money from rental of house?
Yes.
Then no, that may ask the brethren, you know, you go get so and so.
But you see, sometimes.
You sound like
you
a
know.
Man, where, you know, you just a grown bush, so. That's a simple question I ask you. You love talk too much intellectual thing about Jesus and still that's right.
No, man, you have simple to secure your soul. You know,
secure
your
soul. My soul secure, man.
Eh?
There's nothing I can do outside of what is happening here. And nothing can happen to me outside of what is happening here.
But you know, every man's life is limited.
Of course.
And
150 years from now, none of us who is living now will be here.
Yeah, and the fact that we know this is a fact,
mm-hmm.
that immortality is we're all existing under that debt.
Mm.
It is for us living beings
mm-hmm.
to try to understand not only life that we live, but the debt that we have to face, you know.
No, and you can't.
That is where Christ himself come in.
No, man, watch out, man.
That is weird.
Death comes
Christ.
When no man look, man.
Huh?
Death comes when no man look. So you want to know.
True, but you can't.
Ah, you can do. It's prepared for who you're going to live in the life here.
True.
So when you dead?
Yes.
I don't know what you can do to prepare for that.
Well,
more than just try to eat good
2,000
food.
2,000 years ago.
And don't get sick.
2,000 years ago, yeah. The Messiah himself. Make that way clear.
No, man, that's a belief, man. That's what I try to show you. Don't try to impose your belief on me. You hear attacking anything, what I say to you, don't try to impose your belief on me.
But I if don't you don't believe, want to impose my belief on you, then
I
you
don't
should,
believe in your Jesus Christ.
But
you understand?
You should let it rest.
Eh?
You should let it rest.
No, because you know what? It's man like you make I keep talking about it.
No, man, I think you're still troubled by the fact that you will not overcome Christianity.
No, it's
and
man like
far
you.
Believe, the fact that you cannot explain it rationally.
Explain what? There's no rationality to Christian belief. There's no rationality to Christian belief. It's a faith.
Well,
there's no rationality
yeah.
to Christian belief. Christian belief is based upon faith and faith alone.
Well, for it to exist,
faith don't have to have no rationality.
2,000 years ago, then a lot of faith would have to be.
No.
Applied.
The reason why Christianity has existed so long
yeah.
is because of the crusades and the cruelty
no, man,
to impose
make,
this religion and other. But it's not
back.
Roman. Wait there.
Yeah.
Wait there. What's happening? You know that most countries that adhere to Christianity was forced on them by people outside of their country.
Now, if I go back into time,
yes,
when the disciples were going out,
yeah, where them was going out where them was in their own country
into the world.
You don't which world, be yourself, man. Which disciples go into which world?
Christianity did spread in
where the disciples go.
I mean, they started off from Jerusalem,
yeah, and go where
and they spread themselves. Some went to Ethiopia, some went to Egypt, some went to Spain.
Which disciple
went
to Ethiopia?
Huh?
Which disciple went to Ethiopia?
Well, one of the disciples met
no, which disciple got to Ethiopia? I don't know that story.
Well,
I know fifth, them say Philip baptized at Ethiopia, and you know. And him go back to Ethiopia and spread the gospel.
Yes.
But which disciple you know got to Ethiopia?
Well, yeah, but you see, the thing is, the Ethiopians and the people that who once inhabited Jerusalem at the time of Christ were very much related, you know.
Related in what way? In what way?
Eh?
In what way?
Racially and religious belief, because the Ethiopians were long anticipating the coming Messiah, you know, long before
the Ethiopian anticipated was coming. Where the Ethiopian anticipate coming of what Christ? Is Philip baptized an Ethiopian? You know, can him go there with it? Where you talk about
the coming of the Messiah had to be a vision. Before it become a reality.
That is where you imagine.
No.
There's no record of what you said.
Yeah.
Philip baptized an Ethiopian eunuch, and the Ethiopian eunuch go back to Ethiopia with it.
It wouldn't mean anything to him if they weren't living into that.
No, it's colonialism.
it's
colonialism.
The present form of
Christianity colonized the whole Western world and part of the Eastern world.
The present form of religion.
Christianity is perpetuated by violence. Historically, Christianity is a violent religion.
No,
Christianity is what the men them use to control Africa, India.
I mean,
have it all wrong. Show me says lie, me I tell. We should have done already, you know. Show me says lie, me I tell.
Listen, man.
Tell me which country. Who is the biggest perpetrators of the Christian crusade?
The Roman Catholics. The Roman Catholics.
How did the crusaders go about?
Roman Catholics.
The crusaders killed Muslims, killed Jews. The Spanish Inquisition kill off anybody.
Roman Catholics.
But it's Christianity. Wait, when did Europe become Europe? Europe is a new name, you know. It's Christendom, it used the name, you know. Europe used the name Christendom. It's just that they call it Europe. Because the whole of Europe was Christian.
So are you saying now Christ himself was a European then?
No, Christ?
Uh-huh.
Jesus Christ is a Greek Roman mythology. I tell you to tell you that. There's no man on earth that didn't name Jesus Christ.
Alright. For argument.
No argument, no fake. We don't have fake and fake. We are telling you say
yes.
Christianity
uh-huh.
got big through murder, robbery, through crusading, killing.
But Emperor Haile Selassie himself was the last of the crusader king, you know.
Which part of him go crusade?
In his own country.
Oh, you can't crusade. Hey, don't be stupid, man.
No, I'm telling you.
Don't be an asshole, man.
With the assistance.
Don't be an asshole, Panorama, man, at 25 minutes of
with
work.
With the assistance of Rome, France.
Don't be an asshole.
With the assistance of Rome, France, and England. The emperor was assisted.
My brethren.
The emperor was assisted.
My brethren.
To prevent Ethiopia from becoming an Islamic kingdom.
My brethren. Don't be an asshole. Listen to what I say.
Go back to the same book.
Going back.
Going back.
Listen
yes.
to me.
Go back to that book.
I'm telling you.
Yes.
That Christianity, the history of Christianity, has shown me that most of the places in the world that has taken on to Christianity, it got there through killing, raping, pilgrimage, and everything that you call
that
Christianity again.
Disciples, the original
and
disciples.
You know what we have to do now?
Yeah.
We have to leave. Because Ran Mushet stand up behind me at 25 minutes of four.
All right,
sir.
All right,
you say, if you never start talking about Jesus, you can call me again, you know. You so long I don't talk about this subject.
Well, you keep talking.
And no, I can't how you call
I
me again.
I think you're going to get converted eventually.
Oh.
Because no
you see,
man
shall enter Zion. You see, after you try to convert me.
But no man shall enter Zion.
With Zion. You know why I'm not a Zion?
Eh? Well, New Jerusalem belongs to us, you know. And you can only be a Christ to go back there.
You know why I'm going to Zion?
You want to go to Jerusalem?
Me say, for what? I go to Jerusalem already.
You see the people in Jerusalem, they don't really belong there, you know.
Me never see the people them
there. They are just a part of that prophecy. Which
me never see the people them in Jerusalem belong there. Me say, me go to Jerusalem already.
Yeah.
Jerusalem is a geographical place in Israel. I've been there already.
Yes.
I'm not talking about the people them who occupy it.
But Jerusalem belongs to Christ.
Which Christ?
The coming Messiah.
Yeah, what? Go tell the Palestinians that Blombard. Go tell, Blombard, am I bad with that? Them can't lock me up for that. Go tell the Blombard Palestinian them that. Anyway, we're gone.
Yeah, thank you.
All right. This is the Cut Today, IRFM. We're gone, you know. You know what I'm saying? That virgin there, a long time, not call me, you know.
Yeah,
I bet, man. Hey, listen, if I go back on that subject, yeah? Him call me. And if I was a man, we'll look. What them call it? Points? What them call it? When your program go up?
Ratings.
Ratings? Yeah. I don't talk about Jesus every night. Yes. If I talk about Jesus every night, all the people them who hate me come on them radio. Yeah, but if I come and fight, all them man call again. So we are going to this, Junior. Yeah, this is the Cutting Edge, and IRFM coming through.